Okay, good day. So, we will be talking about crimes related to opium and other prohibited drugs na dati nasa Title 5 ng RTC. But now, the prevailing law that we have right now is the Comprehensive Dangerous Drugs Act of 2002, which is RA number 9165. Okay, so let's get on to it. Okay, so Articles 190, 191, 192, and 193 of the Revised Penal Code were repealed by Republic Act 6245, yung Dangerous Drugs Act of 1972, which took effect on March 30, 1972. Okay? So when we say repeal, wala na to. Okay, binura na tong Title 5 sa Revised Penal Code. Ang sinusunod na nating batas, well, noong 1972 is yung RA 6425. Okay? But Republic Act number 9165, also known as Comprehensive Drugs Dangerous Drugs Act of 2002, as amended by Republic Act 10640, ni-repeal niya naman yung RA 6425. So wala na yung RA 6425 na yan. And ang current na law na natin on prohibited drugs is RA 9165 as amended by RA 10640. So, one of the provisions of RA 9165, makikita natin sa section 8, is expressly state that notwithstanding any law, rule, or regulation to the contrary, the provisions of the Revised Penal Code as amended shall not apply to the provisions of this act except in cases of minor offenders. Okay? Where the offender is a minor, the penalty for acts punishable by life imprisonment to death provided herein shall be reclusion perpetua to death. Okay? So yung mga provisions natin sa Revised Penal Code hindi applicable dito sa RA 9165. For example, yung punishment. Ang punishment natin sa Revised Penal Code is reclusion perpetua, temporal, arresto mayor, prison correctional, ganyan. Pero dito sa RA 9165, hindi ganun yung mga punishment dito. Okay? Except na lang in the case of minor offender. Na kapag minor ang nakakumit and ang punishment niya ay life imprisonment to death. Okay? Ang ipoprovide sa kanya ay reclusion perpetua to death. Suspended ang death natin, so reclusion perpetua lang. Okay, ano ang mga punishable acts sa Comprehensive Dangerous Drugs Act of 2002? So, the acts punished are pagdating sa dangerous drugs or controlled precursors and essential chemicals, which means yung mga sabihin na natin ingredients ba sa paggawa ng dangerous drugs. Ayan yung control precursor and essential elements. Pagdating sa mga dyan, punishable lang importation, sale, trading, administration, dispensation, delivery, distribution, and transportation. Maraming beses natin madadaanan tong mga terms na to, so kindly memorize. Manufacture or delivery of equipment, instrument, apparatus, and other paraphernalia. Failure to maintain and keep original records of transactions. Yan yung mga punishable pagdating sa dangerous drugs or controlled precursors and essential chemicals. Okay? Pagdating naman sa mga drug den, dive, or resort, punishable dyan yung pag-maintain ng drug den na yan, ng dive or resort, or being employees or visitors. So, bumisita lang sa drug den. Punishable na yan. Okay? Pero, syempre, hindi naman lahat. Discuss natin later. Pagdating naman sa possession, possession ng dangerous drugs, possession ng equipment, ng instrument, or other paraphernalia para sa mga dangerous drugs, possession ng dangerous drug during parties, social gatherings, or meetings, possession ng equipment, instrument, apparatus, and other paraphernalia for dangerous drugs during parties, social gatherings, or meetings. Pagdating naman sa prescription, ang punishable natin dyan is unnecessary prescription of dangerous drugs and unlawful prescription of dangerous drugs. And others use, syempre, paggamit, cultivation, and illegal chemical diversion, which lahat yan, discuss natin yan thoroughly, isa-isa. Okay, overview okay. lang yan. So, first, what is dangerous drugs? Syempre, dangerous drugs include those listed in the schedule annexed to the 1961 Single Convention on Narcotic Drugs, as amended by 1972 Protocol, and in the schedules of the annex to the 1971 Single Convention on Psychotropic Substances such as opium, morphine, heroin, cocaine, shabu, marijuana resin, marijuana oil, ecstasy, cannabis, PMA, yung mga nasa screen na yan. Okay, LSD, GHB, and those similarly designed or newly introduced drugs and their derivatives without having any therapeutic value or if the quantity possessed is far beyond therapeutic requirements. Okay? So, mamaya, gumawa ka ng panibagong illegal drugs. Sabi mo, hindi naman nakalista dyan eh. Okay? So, kaso sinabi dyan, yung mga similarly designed and mga newly introduced drugs. So, wala kalusot, di ba? Lalo na kung wala naman yung therapeutic value. Okay? So, illegal trafficking. Mga definition of terms muna tayo, okay? Illegal trafficking is the illegal cultivation, culture, delivery, dispensation, manufacture, pagbebenta, trading, transportation, distribution, importation, exportation, and possession of any dangerous drug and or controlled precursor and essential chemical. That is defined under Section 3 ng RA 9165. So, normally, pag sinabi natin trafficking, akala nila mula sa ibang bansa, papunta rito, o dito, papunta sa ibang bansa. Hindi. Okay? Pwede importation yon or exportation. Pero, hindi limited dun yung illegal trafficking. Okay? Nag-deliver ka, nag-administer ka, illegal cultivation, kasama dyan, sale, trading, illegal trafficking na yan. Okay? Pusher, sino man yung mga pusher, ito yung mga tao na nagbebenta, nag-administer, nagdi-dispense, nagdi-deliver, or pinamimigay niya on any terms whatsoever. Okay? May compensation man yan or wala. Or distributes, dispatches, in transits, or transports dangerous drugs, or who acts as a broker of any of such transactions in violation of RA 9165. Siya yung broker. Okay? Side ko, nagbebenta man yan, taga-tusok mo, okay? Taga-dispense, taga-deliver mo yan, pusher yan, okay? Ng mga dangerous drugs. Okay. First, let us discuss the illegal importation of dangerous drugs. So, yung Black Law Dictionary natin defines importation as the act of bringing goods and merchandise into the country from a foreign country. Okay? Mula sa labas, papunta dito sa bansa natin. Thus, para maging held liable ang isang tao for importation of dangerous drugs, yung source niya dapat manggagaling outside of the Philippines. Itong crime of illegal importation committed to by any person na hindi naman siya authorized by law na nag-i-import siya or nagdala siya sa Pilipinas galing sa isang ibang bansa ng dangerous drugs regardless of quantity and purity. When we say regardless of purity or quantity, sabihin natin 2 kilo na powder na kuha sa'yo, kaso hinaluan nyo na 1 kilo na na tawas, 1 kilo lang yung shabu dun or cocaine dun, 1 kilo lang, okay. So ang i-charge sa'yo yung 2 kilo pa rin, okay. Kahit na 1 kilo dun tawas, hindi naman nila iisa-isa yung per butil nun eh. Okay, that is what it meant by regardless of quantity or regardless of purity. Okay? So, including dyan yung all species ng opium poppy, yung dahon. Anyway, malalaman nyo yan sa drugs law or sa yung subject na drugs. or any part thereof, or substances derived therefrom, even for floral, decorative, and culinary purposes. And yung pagdadala rito sa Pilipinas ng controlled precursor and essential chemicals. Okay, yung mga gamit na panggawa ng dangerous drugs. Siyempre, ang opium poppy, ano yan eh? Dahon yan eh. Eh, paano mo gagawin ano yan? Opium. Siyempre, dadali mo sa laboratory. Ladali nila sa laboratory yan. Okay? Ipaprocess nila rin, gagawin nilang opium. So, yung mga kagamitan nila para maiprocess yung opium poppy na yan or yung mga chemicals na gagamitin nila para maging ano yung opium poppy na yan. Yan yung mga controlled precursor and essential chemical. Okay? Do you ever wonder bakit yung ibang mga gamot kailangan may prescription muna bago ka makabili? Okay? Because some of those medicines can be used as a controlled precursor or essential chemical. Okay? Siyempre, hindi sila pwede magbenta sa'yo ng basta-basta na wala kang prescription. Dahil pwede mong gamitin yun as essential chemical or controlled precursor in making a dangerous drugs. Okay? Oh, sample tayo, illegal importation. Merong plastic bag na nagko-contain ng whitish powder. Di pa natin alam kung ano. Nagkakalaman siyang 3 kilo. See? Itong whitish bag, plastic bag na to na may whitish powder, nakita to sa luggage. Luggage na A, sabihin natin. At the Interline office pagdating niya dito sa Manila International Airport. Okay? So, meron yung mga tao na uuna yung ano gamit nila bago sila. So, yung suitcase na yun, dumating yun before the day before sa Thailand International Airways sa Bangkok. So, inside nung suitcase niya, andun yung mga damit tsaka personal effects ni A. So, yung plastic bag containing the white powder was hidden sa secret compartment ng suitcase niya. Okay? Tapos, tinest, laboratory confirmed na yung powder na yun was heroin. So, A, pwede natin siyang kasuhan ng illegal transportation. Okay? Kasi, galing siya sa ibang bansa, dumating siya dito sa Pilipinas. Noong kinapkap yung bag niya, may nakitang drugs doon. Okay? Illegal importation. Yung galing sa ibang bansa, pinasok mo dito sa Pilipinas. Okay? Take note din ah, na prohibited din yung hindi mo pwedeng sabihin na ay bumili po ako ng marijuana pang display lang sa bahay. Hindi pwede yun. The importation ng opium poppy plant parts or kahit ano pa man yan for floral, decorative and culinary purposes is prohibited. Okay, especially opium poppy kasi halaman talaga yan. Okay? So, bawal kang bumili niyan tapos sasabihin mong decoration mo lang yan, floral decoration mo lang yan. Ano mang part ng opium poppy, ano mang klase ng opium poppy, Papa Versominiferum ba yan, Papa Versegeterum, Papa Ver Orientale, Papa Ver Bracteatum Mad, and Papa Ver Reyes. Kahit ano pa yan, kahit buto lang, kahit yung straw, kahit tangkay lang, kahit yung tawag dyan, dahon niya lang, or any part, or any substances na makukuha natin dun sa plants na yan, prohibited yan. Kahit na yung gawin natin siyang decoration lang, o sabihin natin, lulutuin namin yan eh, for culinary purpose, prohibited pa rin yan. Okay? So, yung opium poppy plant kasi, flowering ornamental plant yan na from which doon nang gagaling yung opium and poppy seeds. Okay? Yung poppy seeds are kinoconsume yan as pagkain while the plant may be used for ornamental purposes such as flower arrangement. However, regardless kung saan mo man yan gagamitin, yung importation ng opium poppy or parts niya such as seeds strictly prohibited yan. okay? Thus, kunyari may flower shop owner na nag-import ng opium poppy plants, sasabihin niya, hindi, for flower arrangement lang yan. Liable yan for importation of dangerous drugs. And, yung lack of knowledge niya that such importation is prohibited, hindi yan defense. Sabi niya, ay, hindi ko alam na bawal. Kay tandaan, ignorance of the law, excuses no one. So, next is the Sale, Trading, Administration, Dispensation, Delivery, Distribution, and Transportation. So, STADDDT. Okay? Sale, Trading, Administration, Dispensation, Delivery, Distribution, and Transportation. So, the crime of illegal sale, according to Section 5, Republic Act 91-65, Sale, Trading, Administration, Dispensation, Delivery, Distribution, and Transportation, okay, memorize yan, STADDT, DDDT. Yan. Yung mga ganyan ng dangerous drugs or yung mga controlled precursors and essential elements is committed by any person who, na hindi naman sila authorized by law na magbenta, magtrade, mag-administer, dispense, deliver, or give away to another. Okay? I-distribute nila, dispatch in transit, or i-transport nila yung mga dangerous drugs, okay, including lahat ng species ng opium poppy regardless ng quantity, kung gaano man karami, or purity, okay, or shall act as a broker of any such transaction, middleman, any controlled precursor and essential elements, or act as a broker in such transactions. So, first, let us go to sale. So, when we say sell, this is any act of giving away any dangerous drugs or controlled precursor and essential elements, whether pera man yung kabayaran niyan or merong other consideration. Okay? Bigyan kita ng drugs, gawin mo to. Okay, that's also selling. Okay, at according to Republic Act 91-65. Okay, basta binigay mo yan sa ibang tao, kapalit, pera, or any other consideration, that is already considered as selling. Okay, so, to secure a conviction ng illegal sale of dangerous drugs under Section 5, Article 2 of RA 91-65, the prosecution must establish the following elements. So, una, yung identity ng buyer tsaka yung seller and the object of sale and its consideration. So, i-identify mo sino yung bumibili, sino yung nagbebenta, ano yung binebenta, at yung pera na ginamit. And kailangan din patunayan yung delivery of the thing sold and the payment therefore. Okay? Kailangan mapatunayan din na itong binebenta ay napunta talaga doon sa buyer and itong payment napunta talaga doon sa seller. So, that is the two elements of illegal sale that need to be proven sa court. Okay? What is important dito sa sale and transaction of drugs actually took place. Okay? Nangyari talaga and yung object ng transaction is properly presented as evidence in court. Okay, when we say properly presented, dumaan yan sa tamang chain of custody, which is later we will discuss the process on the chain of custody when it comes to the seizure of illegal drugs. Okay, so properly presented as evidence sa korte and is shown to be the same drugs seized from the accused. Okay, paano natin papatunayan na itong drugs na nakuha sa accused, ito talaga yung drugs na dinala sa court? By way of following the proper procedure for the chain of custody. Okay? So, in cases of illegal sale and illegal possession of dangerous drugs, the dangerous drugs seized from the accused constitutes the corpus delicti of the offense, okay? The body of the crime. Thus, it is of utmost importance that the integrity tsaka yung identity ng nakuhang drugs must be shown to have been duly preserved. Paano natin mapapakita sa court na preserved talaga na maayos? By following pa rin the chain of custody. Okay. Yung chain of custody rule performs this function as it ensures the unnecessary doubts concerning the identity of the evidence removed. Okay. Take note din yung penalty for the sale of dangerous drug. Hindi yan dependent on the quantity involved. Okay? Unlike yung possession where the imposable penalty and nagdedepende kung gaano karami yung drugs na involved sa possession. Okay? Pagdating sa sale, penalty of life imprisonment to death and a fine ranging from 500,000 to 10 million is imposed for the STADDT of dangerous drugs regardless of the quantity involved. Okay? Isang gramo man yan, dalawang gramo man yan, sampung gramo man yan. When it comes to illegal sale, it doesn't matter kung gaano karami ang drugs na binenta mo. Same penalty pa rin. Okay? Sa illegal possession kasi, is nakadepende yung quantity ng drugs. Nakadepende doon kung ano yung magiging penalty mo, which is later on, we will discuss on that. So, trading. When we say trading, define to sa section 3 ng RA 9165 as transactions involving illegal trafficking of dangerous drugs or controlled precursor and essential elements using electronic devices such as, pero hindi lang limited dito ha, text messages, email, mobile, landlines, radio, gumamit ka ng internet, instant messengers, chat rooms, or acting as a broker in any of such transactions, whether para sa pera man yan or for any other consideration, a violation to ng illegal trading. Okay? Example, yung information against yung kaso ni De Lima tsaka ni Guerrero dati, yung information ni Finile against kay Senator Laila De Lima is for illegal drug trading committed as follows. Okay? Si Accused De Lima and Accused Ragos nag-conspire sila and confederate with Accused Dayan with the use of their power, gamit nila yung power nila, yung position nila, yung authority nila, and nag-demand sila, nag-solicit sila, and nag-extort sila ng money from the high-profile inmates ng New Bilibid Prison para masupport yung senatorial bid ni De Lima nung May 2016 election. Okay? By reason of which, the inmates, hindi naman sila lawfully authorized by law, and through the use of mobile phones and electronic devices, okay, na ginamit nila para makipag-usap kay De Lima tungkol dyan, para makipag-trade, did then and merong willfully and unlawfully trade na nangyari and traffic ng dangerous drugs. Okay? And thereafter, give and deliver to De Lima through Ragos and Dayan. Okay? The proceeds of the illegal drug trading. Okay? So that is an example of illegal drug trading. Okay, when we say administration naman, ito yung any act of introducing any dangerous drugs into the body of the person. Okay? Inintroduce mo yung illegal drugs sa katawan ng isang tao. Okay? Meron man o walang knowledge yung tao na yun. Alam niya man o hindi. Eh, paano mo inintroduce? By injection, inhalation, okay, pinakain mo, or other means. Kahit paanong way mo, basta inintroduce mo siya sa katawan ng ibang tao. Hindi sarili mo, ha? Ibang tao. That is illegal administration of illegal drugs. Okay? Na hindi ka naman duly licensed practitioner for purposes of medication. Okay? So, bawal ha? Bawal mag-inject ng kung ano-ano sa katawan ng ibang tao kung hindi ka naman licensed practitioner na ang purpose is for medication. Next is dispensation. When we say dispense, this is an act of giving away, selling, or distributing medicine, take note, or any dangerous drugs nang wala kang prescription. E binenta mo, pinamigay mo, kahit anong gamot yan or kahit dangerous drugs yan. Okay, with or without the use of prescription. That is dispensation. When we say delivery naman, Okay? Dine-define lang natin isa-isa yung STA DDDT para mas maintindihan. When we say delivery, ito yung act of knowingly, okay, passing a dangerous drugs to another, personally man yan or otherwise, by any means, with or without consideration, may bayad man yan o wala, okay, basta pinadala mo itong dangerous drugs mula sa'yo papunta sa ibang tao, by any means, okay, tinricycle man yan, nilalamove man yan, ginrab man yan, gumamit ka man ng courier, okay, may bayad man yan o wala, that is delivery. So what are the elements of delivery? The accused pass on possession of a dangerous drugs to another, personally or otherwise, by any means. Okay? Yung delivery na yan, hindi yan authorized by law. And si accused, knowingly niya na pinadala yung drugs na yun. Okay? Okay, umorder ka ng ano, umorder ka ng cake dito sa isang bakery. Ay, hindi mo alam, nilagyan nila ng drugs yung loob nung cake na yon. Ikaw naman, pinadala mo sa jowa mo yung cake na yon na may lamang drugs, hindi mo alam. Pwede ka bang, pwede ba masabi na delivery yung ginawa mo? Delivery of dangerous drugs. Hindi pwede. Because hindi mo alam na diniliver mo sa kanya yung illegal drugs. Ay, hindi mo naman in-examine yung cake na yon eh. Okay, wala kang purpose para i-examine yung cake na yun bago mo ipadala. Another example. Sa case ng People versus Maongko, hindi naman disputed that yung accused appellant si Maongko, who was working as a taxi driver nung time na naaresto siya, wala siyang authority under the law to deliver any dangerous drugs. Okay, wala siyang authority, taxi driver. Merong prior arrangement between kay Carpio at yung kay Maongko. Okay? Si dumating yung police, si Arugay. Okay? Dumating siya and for his purpose indisposed kasi niya si Carpio and ask for his order of shabu. So yung accused appellant na si Maongko immediately understood what kung ano man yung ibig sabihin ng pulis na yun. So, si accused appellant Maongko, kinuha niya yung sachet ng shabu dun sa bulsa niya and binigay niya dun sa pulis. Okay? Dun sa pulis na kausap niya. So, inaresto siya dun. And si accused appellant Maongko is guilty of illegal delivery ng shabu. Okay? Why? Because alam niya yung ginawa. Alam niya na drugs yung dineliver niya. Hindi naman siya authorized by law na mag-deliver ng ganun. Okay? So, take note din na yung proof of payment, hindi yan necessary pagdating sa illegal delivery of dangerous drugs. Hindi naman sale yung pinag-uusapan natin eh. Okay? So, sa sale mahalaga yung proof of payment. Pero sa illegal delivery, yung tatlong elements lang na ito ang tatandaan. Wala naman nakalagay dyan na kailangan may payment. Okay, so, nakalagay dyan with or without consideration. May bayad man yan o wala. May kapalit man o wala. So, yung kunyari ito, yung presentation of the marked money as well as the fact that the money was paid in exchange for the delivery of dangerous drugs are unnecessary to consummate the crime. Okay? Sa case ng People versus De La Cruz, kahit na si De La Cruz kahit na binigyan ng pera si De La Cruz, was not presented in court. Okay, yung pera na yun, hindi present sa court. And na-convict pa rin si De La Cruz ng delivery of illegal drugs. Why? Because proof of payment, consideration, is not an element of illegal delivery. Okay, manufacture of illegal drugs. When we say manufacture, ito yung production, preparation, compounding, and processing of any dangerous drugs or controlled precursor and essential chemicals. Directly man yan or indirectly by extraction man yan from substances of natural origin or independently by means of chemical synthesis, ginawa sa labs, or combination ng dalawa, extraction and chemical synthesis, and shall include any packaging or repackaging ng substances designed or configuration from of its form, tapos nilabel man yan, or relabeling of its container, except that such terms do not include the preparation, compounding, packaging, labeling of a drug, and other substances by a duly authorized practitioner as an accident to his administration or dispensation of such drugs or substance in the course of his professional practice during research, teaching, chemical analysis of dangerous drugs, and such substances that are not intended for sale or for any other purpose. So, manufacture, very simple. Pag nag-produce ka ng illegal drugs, pin-repair mo yan, na nilagay mo sa container, whether in-extract mo man yung natural origin, for example, yung opium poppy, kaya gumawa ka ng chemical synthesis sa laboratory para makopya yung drugs na yun, okay, pinackage mo yan, nirepackage mo yan, nilagyan mo ng label, yung container, that is manufacture. Ang natatanging exception lang yan kung trabaho mo talaga yun as a legal practitioner during your professional practice. So, itong crime of illegal manufacture is committed to by any person na hindi naman authorized by law na nag-engage sa manufacture ng dangerous drugs. Well, let's talk about the prima facie proof of manufacture of any dangerous drugs. When we say prima facie, okay, on its own, that can be used as evidence on the first view. Well, in layman's term, when we say prima facie, ito talaga yung evidence na patunay talaga na itong crime na to nangyari talaga. Like, for example, once pag sinabi mong may murder na nangyari, ang prima facie evidence is patay talaga yung tao. Okay? Kasi kung hindi patay yung tao, di walang murder na nangyari or walang homicide na nangyari. Okay, that is prima facie in general sense. So, the presence of any controlled precursor and essential elements or laboratory equipment. Okay? Yung presence ng mga controlled precursor, essential elements, essential chemicals, mga laboratory equipment sa paggawa ng dangerous drugs sa clandestine laboratory. Okay? When we say clandestine laboratory, ito yung facility na ginamit for illegal manufacture ng dangerous drugs or controlled precursor and essential chemical. Okay? Ito yung facility, ha? So, yung laboratory equipment mo doon sa facility or sa clandestine laboratory, that is prima facie proof of manufacture of any dangerous drugs. Okay, so it shall be considered aggravating circumstance. When you say aggravating, we have learned in book 1, okay, mapupunta sa maximum penalty or tataas yung penalty mo. Okay? So, magiging aggravating circumstance siya kung yung clandestine laboratory nyo is undertaken or established under the following circumstances. Okay? Yung pagmamanufacture process, gumamit ka ng mga minor. Kasi madaling utuin yung mga yan. Madaling mga organized crime ang gumagamit ng mga minor. Okay? Kasi bukod sa mas madali nila makontrol, hindi nila kailangan bayaran ng malaki. Okay? So, yung manufacturing process mo, within 100 meters siya ng mga residential, business, or church, or school premises. Aggravating circumstance yan. So, yung clandestine laboratory mo, merong mga booby traps to prevent intruders. Okay? O kaya, nakakonsil yan sa legitimate business operation. Okay? Kunyari, akala mo supermarket, sa likod pala, pagawaan ng drugs. So, that is aggravating circumstance. Employment of a practitioner. Nag-employ ka ng practitioner, chemical engineer, para mas maganda yung quality ng drugs na magagawa nyo sa clandestine laboratory nyo. Kaya nag-hire ka ng expert. That is also an aggravating circumstance in the illegal manufacturing. Okay? O kaya, nag-hire ka ng public official for your protection na siguro. Eh? Oh, hire natin si mayor para hindi i-raid tong ano natin, laboratory natin. Okay? Or gumamit ka ng foreigner. Nag-employ ka ng foreigner. Those are the aggravating circumstance when it comes to illegal manufacturing of dangerous drugs. Okay? So, illegal possession. When we say illegal possession of drugs, siyempre, pag po-possess yan, di ba? Committed ito. Dalawa kasi ang possession na insider. Possession ng drugs or possession ng parapernalia. Okay, so wala nga nakuhang marijuana sa'yo. Tangin na, may foil ka naman. Okay, wala nga nakuhang cocaine sa'yo. Diyan naman yung may foil ka tsaka lighter na ginagamit talaga for that purpose. Kaya yung bong, alam mo yung bong. Kasi yung parang tube na mahaba na ewan ko. So, illegal possession of drugs committed ito by any person who hindi naman authorized ng batas. Take note of that always. Who, unless authorized by law. Kasi, malay mo naman, ano, PDEA agent niya na i-deliver lang dun sa laboratory nila. Tapos bigla mong hinuli. Sabi mo, illegal possession of drugs. Siyempre, hindi pwede. Dahil authorized naman siya by law to carry that to their laboratory. Okay? Just example lang. Okay? O kaya, merong etong doktor, pauwi pa lang ng bahay, may mga dala siyang essential chemicals, pwedeng gamitin as essential chemicals. Okay? Nagagamitin niya naman for work niya. May prescription naman siya, tapos huhuliin mo siya for illegal possession. Siyempre, hindi pwede. So, always take note of the unless authorized by law. So, illegal possession of drugs committed by any person who, unless authorized by law, shall possess any dangerous drugs. That is Section 11 RA 9165. Okay. While yung illegal possession naman ng drug paraphernalia committed ito by any person who unless authorized by law shall possess or have under his control lahat ng equipment, instrument, apparatus and other paraphernalia fit or intended, okay? Intended for smoking, consuming, administrating, injecting, ingesting and introducing any dangerous drugs sa katawan. Okay? Kahit anong kagamitan pa yan. Okay? Na intended siya for smoking dangerous drugs. So, what are the elements of illegal possession of drugs? So, si accused, syempre, what's in the possession ng illegal drugs? Okay? Etong possession na ginawa niya, hindi naman authorized by law. And yung accused freely and consciously possess the prohibited drug. Alam niya na nakakapag-possess siya ng illegal drug. Okay? That's the defense of ito, lately ng Seremulya. Okay? Hindi niya daw alam na may laman drugs yung dineliver sa kanya. Bullshit. So, illegal elements naman ng illegal possession of drug paraphernalia. First is the possession or control by the accused of any equipment, apparatus, or any other paraphernalia fit or intended for smoking, consuming, administrating, injecting, ingesting, or introducing any dangerous drug sa katawan ng ibang tao or sa katawan mo, okay, into the body. And yung possession mo ng mga paraphernalia na yan is not authorized by law. Eh, hindi ka naman pinayagan ng batas na mag-carry ng mga ganyang paraphernalia. Okay, take note that yung illegal possession of dangerous drugs is necessary included sa illegal sale, trading, administration, dispensation, delivery, distribution, and transportation of dangerous drugs. Okay? Paano ka naman makakapagbenta, trade, makakapag-administer, makakapag-deliver, distribute, or magta-transport ka ng dangerous drugs kung walang illegal possession, di ba? So, illegal possession, the crime of illegal sale ng dangerous drugs necessarily includes, okay, includes the crime of illegal possession of dangerous drugs. Okay, that is ruled in the case of people versus posada. So, yung same ruling na yun may also be applied to the other acts penalized by Article 2, Section 5 ng RA 9165. Kasi, yung... Kasi for the accused to be able to train to administer para makapag-dispense siya, makapag-deliver, makapag-distribute siya, makapag-dispatch ng kahit anong dangerous drugs, he must necessarily be in the possession. Okay, in possession of said drugs. Hindi niya magagawa yung mga yan kung wala sa possession niya yung drugs na yan. Okay? Also take note that criminal intent hindi yan essential element sa dangerous drugs. Kasi yung illegal possession ng regulated drugs is amala prohibita. Okay? Hindi siya inherently evil, but it is prohibited by law. So, hindi mo ma... So, yung criminal intent, hindi siya essential element. However, para ma-prove itong possession, the prosecutor must prove that the accused meron siyang intent to possess the drugs. Kaya yung tinatawag natin na aminus possidendi. Meron siyang intent to possess. Yung possession under sa batas natin, kasama dyan yung hindi lamang actual possession but also constructive possession. Okay? Actual possession, pag sinabi natin actual possession, ito yung drugs nasa immediate possession mo or control of the accused. Eh, nasa bulsa mo, hawak mo, nasa bag mo. That is actual possession. When we say constructive possession naman, nag-e-exist ito when the drug is under the dominion and control of the accused or when he has the right to exercise dominion and control over the place where it is found. Nakita yan sa bahay mo, wala ka naman sa bahay nung time na nag-search. Nasa trabaho ka. So, pwede ka parang kaso na illegal possession because you have the control, okay, dun sa domain kung saan nakita yung drugs. Exclusive possession or control, hindi yan necessary. Okay? The accused cannot avoid conviction if he has, kung yung right to exercise control and dominion over the place where the contraband is located is shared with another. Okay? Yung kasama mo pala sa bahay under the possession of illegal drugs, possible kaya na makasuhan ng illegal possession because you also have the control and domain over the place where the drugs was found, lalo na kung sa mga common area niya yan. Except na lang if siguro sa drawer niya, kwarto niya, na bawal ka pumasok. Okay. Sa rule ng animus possidendi, yung mere possession of prohibited drug constitutes prima facie evidence of knowledge or aminus possidendi sufficient to convict an accused in the absence of satisfactory explanation. Okay? So, yung mere possession na yan, prima facie evidence kagad yan. And sufficient yan to convict a person, lalo na kung wala naman siyang satisfactory explanation kung bakit in under possession siya ng ganun. May pinoposess siyang dangerous drugs. So, yung finding of illicit drugs and paraphernalia sa, sabihin natin, isang bahay or building na owned or occupied by a particular person raises the presumption of knowledge and possession thereof, which standing alone is sufficient na yan para ma-convict siya of illegal possession. Okay? So, in a case where the policeman who raided the house and nakahanap siya ng opium or paraphernalia sa table around which the appellants and co-accused were gathered, it was held that the appellants and their co-accused are presumed the possession thereof, and such illegal possession of such prohibited article, a prima facie evidence yan that they have used the prohibited drug. Okay? Ano may example ng ano? Pag sinabi nating merong lack of intent to possess. So, lack of intent, no? Ano ba? Kunyari, si policeman, habang nagsasearch siya ng bahay para sa opium, okay? yung lalaki, sinabihan niya asawa niya. Sinabihan niya asawa niya na kunin yung tinatago niyang opium dum sa ilalim ng unan ng lalaki, tapos itapon dapat ng babae. So, etong babae na to, wala siyang intent to possess the opium. Okay? Walang proof that she knew that yung unan nung asawa niya eh merong opium. Okay? The mere fact that she took possession of it under husband's order is not a possession. Okay? And as it is intended to be condemned by law. Okay? So, si accused, pwede niyang marebut the presumption of knowledge and establish the absence of knowledge on his part as to the presence of the drugs doon sa premises niya. Okay? In this case, yung appellant testified that until the moment nung search, na wala siyang knowledge of the presence nung drugs doon sa unan nung husband niya. So, sabi niya, dineclare niya that the business was under the control, yung bahay was under the control nung asawa niya. Okay? So, na-acquit ito. Okay? Ano naman example ng illegal possession of drugs? Kanina, lack of intent to possess. Okay? So, itong si accused na kinapkapan legally, tapos na nakakuha ng marijuana sa bulsa niya. Okay? So, si accused hindi siya nag-offer ng any explanation kung bakit may marijuana sa bulsa niya. Okay? O kung authorized ba siya ng law na magdala ng marijuana ng ganun. So, based on the dangerous drugs report, yung dried crushed leaves and seeds nakabalot sa newspaper and contained in a transparent plastic tea bag which gave a positive result for marijuana na may timbang na 1 gram. Okay, so nakasuhan siya ng illegal possession of drugs. Example, illegal possession of drug paraphernalia. So, yung mga police, nag-serve sila ng search warrant sa bahay na accused. Okay? Meron sila mga nakita na mga aluminum foil na nakalagay sa transparent plastic bags. Okay? Several pieces of used plastic sachet in a transparent tea bag in a plastic tube intended for sniffing shabu was found. So, similar to the marijuana, the accused failed to justify his possession ng mga paraphernalia na yan. So, significantly, the dangerous drugs report showed that the examination made on the washing of these confiscated items merong positive result for the presence of methamphetamine hydrochloride. Okay, merong shabu. May presence ng shabu. Nung tinest yung mga foil na yun. So, that is drug paraphernalia. He was charged with illegal possession of drug paraphernalia. Take note that illegal possession of prohibited drugs during social gatherings is more severely punished. Okay? Yung maximum of the penalty shall be imposed if illegal possession of drugs or drug paraphernalia is during parties, mga social gatherings, meetings, or in the proximate company of at least 2 persons. Okay? Remember that what the law punishes is present possession of dangerous drugs. So, kunwari, nakitaan ka ng bakas ng drugs sa damit mo. For example, nag-cause ng stain or yung mga derivative upon the hands sa damit mo, that person cannot be convicted of having in his possession yung opium and its derivatives. Okay? Kasi yung stains of opium or drugs, diba? May stain sa damit mo, indicates merely past possession yun. Okay? Hindi yun present possession. what the law punishes is the present possession of opium. Okay, that is the case of US versus Tansengi. Yung term na self-possess, hindi lang yan limited sa manual touch or personal custody, ha? A principal acting through an agent comes within the purview of this expression. Okay? Let's say, for example, si A. Si A, isang pusher or whatever. Okay? So, ang ginawa niya, hindi, ganito na lang. Si A, isa siyang mamamangka. Okay? So, merong bangka si A. Medyo malaki yung bangka niya. So, ang ginagawang trabaho ni A, nagde-deliver siya. Okay? Or sabihin natin na nangingisda siya. So, sa bangka ni A, na masyado medyo malaki, may mga barrel doon ng mga isda, pagkain ng isda, or kung ano-ano pa man, may mga sako ng gulay, if ever. Okay? Sabihin natin, merong isang sako doon. Tapos, hindi niya alam na naglalaman ng opium yung sako na yun, ng dangerous drugs. Hindi siya liable. Okay? Pero yung may-ari nun, magiging liable for possession. Kahit na walang manual touch. Wala naman siya dun sa barko eh. Okay? Wala naman yung may-ari. Sabi na si B yung may-ari nung sako na yun na punong-puno ng drugs. Okay? Na nasa bangka ni A. So si B liable siya for illegal possession kahit na wala siya doon sa mismong barko. Okay? Kahit na nakita yung opium or drugs doon sa possession ni A. Okay? Yung words na shall possess. that is, ito yung relation between the owner of the drug and the drug itself. Okay? When the owner is not in the actual physical possession, pero is still under his control and management and subject pa rin yung drug sa kanyang disposition. Pagmamay-ari niya pa rin yun. Okay? What about yung mga patent medicine containing opium? Okay, meron yung mga ganun. Mga medicine na may lamang opium. Siguro konti lang. So, the legislature, yung gumagawa ng batas, Congress, has intended to penalize the unauthorized use of opium kahit na for medical purposes. Okay? Kasi ginagamit naman yan for medical purposes. Eh. Kasi opium, halaman yan. Okay? Hindi yan chemically synthesized. So, the law authorizes its use as medicine. Pero dapat merong prescription by a physician. Okay? Pero yung innocent purchaser of a patent medicine or other medical preparation na hindi naman siya aware that such preparation contains opium, hindi rin yun guilty. Okay? Yung possession naman ng opium on board a vessel is punishable when Philippine port is its destination. So when a foreigner steamer, sabi, steamer ng mga foreigner, nag-anchor sila isa sa mga ports natin after arriving directly from a foreign country, yung mere possession of opium therein is punishable. Okay? Nag-anchor sila sa bansa natin. Eh. But the ruling does not apply kung yung foreign vessel na yun is in transit. Okay? Napadaan lang, in which case mere possession of opium therein is not punishable. Okay, kasi hindi naman destination yung Philippine port. Next is, we will discuss about drug den, dive, and resort. So, ano ba to? Ang isang drug den, dive, or resort, sinabi ko na yan kanina, ito yung place where any dangerous drug or controlled precursor and essential chemical is administered, delivered, stored for illegal purposes, distributed, sold, or use in any form. That is provided in Section 3 RA 9165. So, yung crime of maintenance of a den, dive, or resort is committed by any person, okay, any person or group of person na nag-maintain ng den, dive, or resort where Any dangerous drugs is used or sold in any form, or any controlled precursor and essential element is used or sold in any form. Okay? Ayan yung manakakumit. So, yung isang employee ng den, dive, or resort na aware of the nature of the place as such, alam niya na pagawaan dun ini-store yung mga illegal drug. Okay? And a person na hindi naman employee, pero aware siya na yung place, eh, ganun nga, ginawang den, dive, and resort. Tapos, bumisita pa rin siya dun sa lugar na yun. Liable sila ng Section 6 ng RA 9165. Okay? Kahit bumisita lang, bumisita ka lang dun sa lugar na yun. Pero alam mo na ginagamit siya as a drug din. You are still liable ng violation ng Article 6. Okay? O kaya yung mga employee nun, nung lugar na yun, na alam nila na ganun yung purpose ng lugar na yun. Violation pa rin yun ng Section 6. Okay, so based dyan, sino yung mga liable? So, una yung mga persons na nagme-maintain ng drug den, dive, or resort where any dangerous drugs is used or sold. Yung mga employees ng isang den, dive, or resort na aware sila yung nature ng lugar na yun. Okay? Yung visitor ng den, dive, or resort na yan, who is aware of the nature of the of the place. Okay? So, sila yung mga persons liable dyan. Okay? So, ano elements ng maintenance ng isang drug den? Okay? So, una, yung place is of course is a den. Pag sinabi natin den, a place where any dangerous drugs or controlled precursor and essential chemicals is administered, delivered, stored for illegal purposes, distributed, sold, or used in any form. Okay? So, the accused maintains the said place. Okay? That's the two elements. Okay? Yung den na yun na ginagamitan para sa mga illegal illicit activities na tungkol sa drugs. And yung accused, siya yung nagme-maintain nung drug den. Okay? That is a violation of maintenance of a drug den. So, a drug den in layman's term, ito yung lair or hideaway where prohibited or regulated drugs are used in any forms or are found. Okay? Yung existence niya may be proved hindi lamang by direct evidence, but may also be established by proof of facts and circumstances, including evidence of the general reputation of the house or its general reputation among police officers. So, this fact was proven by, sabi na, testimony ng isang pulis, sabi natin, siya yung nagpapanggap na buyer who matapos siyang bumili ng shabu and sinabi niya dun sa appellant that he wanted to sniff the same, to which the latter responded by requiring the former to pay a rental fee ng, sabi natin, 10 piso. Okay? So the appellant then allowed P.O. to Martinez na pumasok sa bahay niya and directed him to proceed to one of the rooms located at the right side of the sala. So, pagpasok ng pulis sa isang kwarto na yon, nakita ni P.O. to Martinez tatlong person na sumisinghot na ng shabu. So, yung testimony na itong ni P.O. to Martinez was corroborated by another 2 police officer. So, moreover, marami rin nakuhang peso bills dun sa wallet ng appellant, okay, including 30 piso, sabihin natin, which the circumstances bolstered the prosecution's assertion that the appellant has indeed allowed his house to be used as a drug den for 10 pesos per person. Okay? Parang renta mo isang bahay, doon ka mag doon ka mag-session. That is a drug den. Take note that for an accused to be convicted of maintenance ng isang drug den, the prosecution must establish with proof beyond reasonable doubt that the accused is maintaining a drug den where any dangerous drug is administered, used, or sold. So, kailangan ding establish that the alleged drug den is a place where dangerous drugs are regularly sold and or used by customers of the maintainer of the den. So, sa case ng People versus Galicia, at yung prosecution, hindi sila nagwagi na establish na yung isang shanty where the appellant was found was a place where dangerous drugs were sold or used. So yung witness ng prosecution merely testified that they were entered target number 8. So they found drug paraphernalia inside the shanty and sachets of crystalline substance in the person of the appellant. So the prosecution failed to allege and prove an essential element of the offense. The yung din na yun ay ginagamit para makapagbenta ng dangerous drugs or para makagamit inside the shanty located at target number 8. So, ang malinaw dun was that the appellant was caught in the possession ng shabu at drug paraphernalia. Okay? Pero walang evidence that would indicate that the arresting officers saw that dangerous drugs were being sold or is being used at target number 8 in the course of the search of the premises. Since walang evidence na nagbebenta nga ron or pinaggagamitan yun ng dangerous drugs, hindi pwedeng maging liable si appellant for violation ng section 6, okay, ng maintenance of drug din. Okay, pwede siyang maging liable for possession. Pag sinabi nating employee ng isang den dive or resort, na sila yung caretaker, helper, watchman, lookout, or other persons na nagtatrabaho doon sa den dive or resort na employed nung maintainer, nung owner, or nung operator, kung saan yung lugar maraming nag-administer, deliver, distribute, sold, or use ng dangerous drugs, okay? With or without compensation in connection with the operation thereof. Okay? So, basta nagtatrabaho ka sa isang drug den, then you are still liable. Okay? So, paano naman yung mga visitor na bumisita sa isang drug den, pero alam nila na drug den yun. So, before a person may be convicted of knowingly visiting a drug den, it must be shown that alam niya na yung lugar na binisita niya was a drug den. Pero binisita niya pa rin despite his knowledge. Okay? So sa court, the prosecution must prove that the visitor knew that the place was a drug den. Okay? Assuming that yung persons who test positive for drugs use them at the place of the arrest is not sufficient to show that they were aware of the nature of the suspected drug den before visiting it. Okay? Absent any other circumstantial evidence. Wala namang attempt to show that petitioners knew the nature of the alleged drug den or even that they used drugs in the premises. Ang alam lang natin is gumamit sila ng drugs dahil nag-positive sila. Pero hindi natin alam na dun ba nila ginamit dun sa lugar na yun, yung drugs na yun. Okay? Or that na alam nila na drug din yun. So, the petitioners were not found to be in possession of any drugs. When the petitioners were arrested, nobody was found in the act of using, selling, or buying illegal drugs. O kaya nagpa-package, nag-hide, nagta-transport ng mga illegal drugs na yan. So, there were no acts alleged or evidence found, which would tend to show a familiarity with the nature of the place as a drug den. Okay? Walang indication na yung lugar na yun is a drug den. So, petitioners are acquitted of the charge of knowingly visiting a drug den. Okay? But, dahil nga nag-test sila ng positive for drugs, they are still liable for the use of dangerous drugs, which we will discuss next. Okay? Pero, take note muna that A person who visited another, okay, bumisita ka sa bahay ng tropa mo, yung tropa mo nagsasabu, hindi ka liable. Okay? Kung yung lugar naman na yun, hindi naman yung drug den, dive, or resort. Okay? Bahay niya lang yun. Siya lang yung gumagamit doon. Hindi naman siya nagbebenta rin, hindi siya nagre-package, hindi niya yung ginagamit para mag-store ng mga illegal drugs niya. Okay? Take note of the case of US versus Sibon Q. The accused was charged with having permitted one Ong Ting to use opium personally with having knowingly visited the place where the said Chinaman was smoking opium. So it was held that it was not unlawful. Hindi naman unlawful para makasama mo yung pagsama mo sa isang tao sa kwarto niya tapos gumamit siya ng opium doon. Okay, unless yung lugar na yon is an opium den. Okay? Next is the use of dangerous drugs. So when we say use, ito yung act of injecting intravenously man o intramuscularly, of consuming, either ninunguya mo yan, ginawa mo sigarilyo, sininghot mo, kinain mo, nilunok mo, ininom mo, or otherwise, basta inintroduce mo yan sa physiological system ng katawan mo, yung mga dangerous drugs na yan, then that is considered use. Okay? Inintroduce mo sa katawan mo. So, what is the prima facie evidence of use? The possession of equipment, instrument, apparatus, and other paraphernalia fit or intended for smoking, consuming, administrating, injecting, ingesting, or introducing any dangerous drugs into the body shall be the prima facie evidence that the possessor has smoked, consumed, administered sa kanyang sarili, injected, ingested, or used a dangerous drugs and shall be presumed to have violated Section 15 on the use of dangerous drugs. Okay? So, take note na if use and possession nagko-coexist yan. Hindi ka naman makakagamit kung wala sa iyo yung drugs na yun. Okay? So, if nagko-coexist yung dalawa, ang penalty natin is for possession. Okay? If the person tested also found to have in his or her possession such quantity of any dangerous drugs, then the penalty for possession shall be imposed. Okay? Take note also that drug trafficking. Okay, dito ba? Wala. Ito. Drug trafficking is punished more harshly than drug use. Okay? The intention of the legislator sa Section 4, 24, sorry, ng RA 9165 is to prove stiffer and harsher punishments for those persons convicted of drug trafficking or pushing, while extending a sympathetic magnanimous hand sa Section 70 to drug dependents who are found in guilty of violation ng drug use. Okay? So, mas malala ang drug trafficking and drug pushing. Mas malala ang penalty nun instead sa drug use. Okay? Kasi the law considers yung users and possessor ng mga illegal drugs as victim. Okay? Biktima lang daw sila. While the drug traffickers and pushers, sila naman yung mga predator. Hence, while drug traffickers and pushers are categorically disqualified from availing the law on probation, okay, bawal mag-probation, youthful drug dependence users and possessors alike are given the chance to bend their ways. Okay? The law indeed appears strict and harsh against sa mga drug traffickers and drug pushers while protective sa mga drug users. Okay? To illustrate ganito, isipin nyo, isang tao, inaresto siya for illegal and dangerous drugs. Okay? Illegal use of dangerous drugs. And is meted only, penalty niya lang, 6 months rehabilitation sa isang government center. As minimum. Okay? For the first offense under Section 15. Pero yung isang tao charged and convicted of selling dangerous drugs, meron siyang penalty na life imprisonment to death and a fine ranging from 500 pesos to 10 million under section 5 ng RA 9165. Okay? Take note also that the use of dangerous drugs is a qualifying aggravating circumstance in the commission of the crime. Okay? So, yung positive finding for the use of dangerous drugs shall be qualifying aggravating circumstance in the commission of a crime by an offender. So, yung application of the penalty provided for sa revised penal code shall be applicable. Okay? Section 25, yan yung sinabi ng Section 25, RA 9165. When it comes to prescription of dangerous drugs, alam niyo naman siguro kung ano yung prescription, okay? Meron dalawang acts related sa prescription of dangerous drugs na nagva-violate sa RA 9165. Una, unnecessary prescription of dangerous drugs. Okay? And pangalawa, yung unlawful prescription of unnecessary drugs. So, ang pinagkaiba nila. So, yung unnecessary prescription committed ito by a practitioner. Okay? Na nag-prescribe siya ng dangerous drugs sa isang tao na hindi naman nangangailangan. Okay? As determined by the Dangerous Drugs Board in consultation with recognized competent experts who are authorized representatives of the professional organization of practitioners, particularly those who are involved in the care of persons with severe pain. Okay. Si practitioner, nag-prescribe siya ng dangerous drugs sa hindi naman nangangailangan. Okay? Pag sinabi natin practitioner, ito yung any person na licensed physician, dentist, chemist, medical technologist, nurse, midwife, veterinarian, pharmacist dito sa Pilipinas. Okay? Yung unlawful prescription naman, ito yung committed dito by any person, hindi na practitioner lang. Okay? Any person na hindi naman authorized by law na nag-issue siya ng prescription or any other writing na nag kunwari prescription ganun for any dangerous drugs, okay? Bale nagsulat siya ng prescription or pinagmukha niyang prescription for dangerous drugs. So that's the difference between unlawful prescription of dangerous drugs and unnecessary description of dangerous drugs. Next is cultivation and culture. Okay? When we say cultivation and culture, ito yung act knowingly, nagpa-plant ka, papalaki, nagre-raise, or permitting the planting, growing, or raising of any plant which is the source of a dangerous drugs. Okay? Datarim ka na pala ng opium poppy sa likod ng bahay nyo, or pinayaga mo ibang tao na magtanim ng opium poppy sa likod ng bahay mo. Okay? You are liable for cultivation or culture. Okay? Illegal cultivation or illegal culture. So, committed yan by any person na nagtanim, nagcultivate, or culture ng marijuana, opium poppy, okay? Or any other plant regardless of kung gaano man yan karami, which is or may hereafter be classified as dangerous drugs or a source from which any dangerous drugs may be manufactured or derived. Okay? Yung mga natural plants na pinagkukuhanan ng mga dangerous drugs, nag-cultivate ka niyan. So, you are liable for illegal cultivation. Okay? Sa case ng People versus Alunday, yung appellant was convicted of illegal cultivation and culture of prohibited drugs based on the following. So, yung police contingent traded a nag-raid sila ng marijuana plantation sa Mountain Province. So, in the course ng pag-raid nila, yung appellant, nakita nila na nag-gather ng marijuana plants from the premises. Okay? Walang ibang halaman doon except marijuana which were growing doon sa area na sinabi natin. Okay? And there was a hut apparently used by the appellant and an old woman as a camp or temporary dwelling which existed alone within the area of the subject plantation. yung samples taken from the said plantation were all found to be positive for marijuana. Okay. So, ayun yung example ng illegal cultivation. Sa ano pa? Zonaria versus Court of Appeals. Yung mga members ng Philippine Army, nakahanap sila ng plantation ng marijuana plants sa Cebu. So, ang sabi ng court, the court held that a person who failed to adequately explain his presence at the plantation, kung bakit siya nandun, na dun sa plantation na punong-puno ng marijuana, is guilty of illegal cultivation and culture. Okay? However, yung itong case ng People versus Acosta, yung mga police officers found marijuana plants beneath gabi plants. Okay? May mga gabi plants pero may marijuana plants din dun sa bahay ng accused after receiving a report na yung accused ay nagplanta ng marijuana. Okay? So the court held that yung mga seized plants were inadmissible as evidence as their discovery was inadvertent. Okay? As held in People versus Valdez, yung Plainview Doctrine, remember, cannot apply if the officers actually searching for the evidence against the accused kung wala naman silang warrant of search. Next is chemical diversion. So, chemical diversion, ito yung sale, distribution, supply, transport, and legitimately imported in transit, manufactured, or procured controlled precursor and essential elements in diluted mixture or in concentrated form to any person or entity engaged in the manufacture of any dangerous drugs and shall include packaging, repackaging, labeling, relabeling, or concealment of such transactions through fraud, destruction of documents, fraudulent use of permits, misdeclaration, use of front companies, or mail fraud. So, chemical diversion is legal yung pag-i-import dito ng controlled precursor or essential chemicals. Either malay mo gagamitin yan for legal medicine. Okay? So, kaya nag-i-import dito. Okay? Basta legal. Merong permit. Okay? O kaya, walang permit, fraudulent use of permit. Basta, legitimately imported. Binenta nila sa nagmamanufacture. So, that is chemical diversion. Okay, binenta sa mga nagmamanufacture legitimately imported or legitimately manufactured na controlled precursor and essential chemicals. So, ang illegal chemical diversion committed ito by any person who, unless authorized by law, shall illegally divert any controlled precursor and essential chemicals. Bypass operation naman, ito yung form of entrapment which in recent years tinatanggap ito as valid means of arresting violations ng dangerous drugs law natin. Okay? Commonly employed to ng mga police officers as an effective way of apprehending law offenders in the act of committing a crime. So, sa isang bypass operation, ang idea is to commit a crime originates from the offender without anybody inducing or prodding him to commit the offense. Okay? Hindi siya in-induce ng kahit sino na gumawa ng offense. Sa bypass ha, remember, wala nag-induce sa kanila. Yung pag-commit ng offense, nag-originate yan dun sa offender. Walang pumigil sa'yo na magbenta sa akin yung sabu. Okay? So, nung nagbenta ka sa akin, huhulihin kita. Iba yun sa inducement, sa instigation. Whereas, sa instigation, merong inducement na nangyari. In-induce mo siya na gumamit ng drugs, tapos sinuli mo siya, bawal yun. Okay? That is contrary to public policy and considered siya as an absolutory cause. Okay? As you may remember sa book 1, an absolutory cause is not punishable because may liability but no imprisonment shall be imposed because of reasons of public policy. Yun yung instigation. So, bawal ang instigation pero pwede ang bypass operation. Because yung crime, nag-originate yan sa offender. Okay, walang pumilit sa kanya na gawin yung bagay na yan. Okay. Instigation, merong nag-induce sa kanya na gumawa ng illegal na bagay. So, that is prohibited. That is an absolutory cause. So, merong mga objective test na tinatawag sa bypass operation. So, sa isang bypass operation, yung prosecution, must present a complete picture detailing the transaction. Etong transaction na to dapat nag-start to from the initial contact nung nagpapanggap na buyer tsaka yung pusher. Okay? Kasama yung offer to purchase, yung promise ng or payment of the consideration until the consummation of the sale by the delivery of the illegal subject of the sale. Okay? So dapat ma-present yung complete picture mula sa nagkaroon ng initial contact dun sa nagpapanggap tsaka dun sa bebenta. Okay, hanggang sa nagpalitan sila, nagbayad, hanggang sa napunta dun sa nagpapanggap yung drugs. Okay? We emphasize dito sa sabi ng court sa case ng People versus Doria, we emphasize that the manner by which the initial contact was made, the offer to purchase the drug, the payment of the bypass money, and the delivery of the illegal drugs must be subject to strict scrutiny by the courts to ensure na ang isang law-abiding citizens are not unlawfully induced to commit an offense. Okay? Na walang nag-induce sa kanila na gawin yung pagbebenta na yun. That's why, kailangan mula umpisa hanggang sa ma-deliver yung drugs, kailangan ma-present yun sa court. Okay? Para hindi iisipin na baka na-induce lang yan na magbenta ng drugs. Okay, yung sinasabi ko kanina, paano natin papatunayan yung mga bagay-bagay na diniscuss natin kanina kung etong drugs ba na nakuha sa crime, sa accused, sa suspect, same drugs na ipepresent sa konte by observing the proper chain of custody. So, the chain of custody is defined as the duly recorded authorized movement of and custody ng mga seized drugs or controlled chemicals or plant sources of dangerous drugs or laboratory equipment of each stage from the time of seizure mula sa time na kinonfiscate sila to receive in the forensic laboratory for safekeeping. Okay? So, ito yung recorded movements kung sa, na kanino napunta yung droga mula ng sinis siya. Okay? Mula nang kinonfiscate yung drugs hanggang mapunta sa forensic laboratory for safekeeping. Okay? To presentation in court for destruction. So, lahat ng taong dinaanan, kailangan nakarecord yan. Ayan ng chain of custody. So, itong record of movements and custody of seized items shall include the identity, signature of the person who held temporary custody of the seized item, yung date and time when such transfer of custody were made in the course of safekeeping and used in court as evidence, and the final disposition. Lahat yan naka-record. So, the chain of custody rule requires that the admission of an exhibit be preceded by evidence sufficient to support a finding that a matter in question is what the proponent claims it to be. Okay? Ideally, yung evidence presented by the prosecution must include testimony about every link in the chain. Okay? So, kung sino, kanino man dumaan yan, sinong humawak yan, sino nag-transfer, lahat yun kasama sa testimony ng prosecution. Okay? From the moment na kinuha yan, okay, hanggang mapunta yan sa court for evidence. Sinong kumuha niyan, sinong humawak niyan. Lahat sila magte-testify sa court. Okay? So, the prosecution should present evidence establishing the chain of custody in such a way that lahat ng tao na humawak nung exhibit na yun would describe kung paano nila na-receive yan, ano yung itsura nila nung na-receive, ano yung condition nila nung na-receive, okay, nasaan yan nung, nasaan sila nung na-receive yan, what happened to it while in the witness possession, okay, the condition in which it was received and the condition in which it was delivered to the next link in chain. Okay? Ano yung condition ng evidence nung na-receive mo at ano yung condition ng evidence nung binigay mo na siya dun sa next na tao. Okay? In addition, itong mga witness na ito should describe the precaution taken to ensure that there has been no change in the condition of the item and that there had been no opportunity for someone not in the chain to have possession of the same. Okay. Kailangan ding i-describe yun. Okay. Paano mo, nung nasa iyo yung evidence, paano mo siya inalagaan? Okay. Ano yung mga precautions mo na ginawa para masigurado na hindi napalitan yung evidence na yan? Okay. So, the links that the prosecution must establish in the chain of the custody in a bypass situation are as follows. Okay? Ito yung mga link na kailangan i-establish. Okay? Yung seizure and marking of the illegal drug recovered from the accused by the apprehending officer. Okay? Yung turnover of the illegal drug seized by the apprehending officer to the investigating officer. Okay, yung turnover niya. Yung turnover ni investigating officer papunta dun sa forensic chemist ng laboratory examination. Tapos mula kay forensic chemist papunta sa submission sa court. Okay? So i-establish lahat 'yan, lahat ng dinaanan. Okay? When nagging doubts, pag merong duda, okay, kung itong item ba na ito eh parehas, ito yung same specimen examined and established to be prohibited drug, then walang crime of illegal possession of a prohibited drug. Okay, kapag merong duda na hindi ito yung drugs na nakuha sa kanya, napalitan to throughout the chain of custody. Okay, kung may dudang ganun, then walang crime of illegal possession na mapuproof. So, the required procedure in seizure and custody of drugs. Provided yan, remember, under section 21 of the Article 2 ng IRR ng RA 9165 as amended by RA 10640. So, una, the apprehending officer or yung apprehending thief, meron silang initial custody and control of the dangerous drugs, controlled precursors and essential chemicals, instruments, paraphernalia, and laboratory equipment. Shall, remember shall, so it is mandatory. Okay? Immediately after seizure and confiscation, magkakandak sila ng physical inventory of the seized item. At the same time, pipicturan nila yan in the presence ng accused. Okay? Take note of this, presence ng accused, persons or the persons from whom the such items were confiscated or seized, or his representative or counsel, okay, kasama ng elective public official and representative of the National Prosecution Service or the media, who shall be required to sign copies of the inventory and be given copy thereof. Okay? So, tatlo. Tatlo yung witness habang nagkakandak ka ng photograph and physical inventory. Yung accused or kung sino man yung tao na nakuhanan, okay, or representative niya, okay, kasama ng elected public official and representative ng National Prosecution Service or the media. Okay? Provided na yung physical inventory na yan, yung photograph na yan, shall be conducted dun sa place, okay, kung saan sinerve yung search warrant, if ever man, okay, na hindi yan in flagrante delicto, or at the nearest police station or at the nearest office of the apprehending team of officer, kung saan man yung pinaka-practicable. Okay? So, it's either dun mismo, sa pinakamalapit na police station, or sa office ng apprehending officer or team. Dun nila pipicturan it in the document. Okay? Provided further na yung non-compliance ng mga requirements na to under justifiable grounds, as long as the integrity and the evidentiary rule of the seized items are properly preserved by the apprehending officer or team, shall not be rendered void and invalid such seizure and custody over the said items. Okay? So, after nun, okay, after 24 hours, within 24 hours, upon confiscation and seizure ng dangerous drugs na yun, okay, mga plant sources, controlled precursor, and essential elements, kasama yung paraphernalias, equipments, okay, within 24 hours, dapat masubmit na yan sa PDEA Forensic Laboratory. Specific na kalagay, PDEA. Okay? Forensic Laboratory for the qualitative and quantitative examination. Okay? Specific na kalagay, PDEA. But sabi nila, kapag malayang PDEA, hindi practicable, or maraming ginagawa na available, pwede na sa PNP lab. Okay? Pero, kapag available ang PDEA, doon muna dapat. Okay. After mag-conduct ng lab ng qualitative and quantitative examination, kailangan i-certify yan ng forensic laboratory examination. Okay, i-certify nila yung results. Which shall be done under oath. Under oath by the forensic laboratory examiner. Shall be issued within 24 hours after nila ma-receive yung i-examine nila. Okay? So, picture-picture, documentation, sa harap ng tatlong witness, okay, sa either sa malapit na police station, dun mismo, or sa office, okay, whichever is practicable. Within 24 hours, that madala na yan sa PDEA. Okay? After madala, within 24 hours, dapat ma-certify na yan nung forensic laboratory examinator. Okay. And yung certification na yan shall be done under oath. Okay. Yung strict compliance with the prescribed procedure required dito. Okay. Because of the illegal drug's unique characteristic rendering it indistinct, not readily identifiable, and madaling matamper. Okay. Madaling ma-alter or madaling ma-substitute either by accident or intentional. Kaya kailangan sumunod sa strict procedure. In marking of seized evidence, okay? So, dalawa yung titignan natin dyan. Sa either seizure covered by search warrant and seizure covered by warrantless search. Okay? Warrantless seizure. Yung venues of the physical inventory and photography ng mga seized items differ depend upon kung yung seizure ba ay made with virtue of a search warrant or through a warrantless seizure such as bypass operation. Okay? In seizures covered by searches, the physical inventory and photograph must be conducted kung saan sinerve yung search warrant. Okay? Saan nag-conduct ng search. On the other hand, in case of warrantless seizure naman, such as bypass operation, yung physical inventory, yung photograph, yung first step dun sa procedure natin, shall be conducted sa nearest police station or office ng apprehending team, okay, whichever is practicable. However, wala namang pumipigil sa apprehending team or officer na mag-conduct kaagad ng physical inventory and photograph of the items kung saan sila na-seize kahit pa warrantless search yan. Okay? As it is more keeping with the law's intent in preserving their integrity and evidentiary rule. Okay? Ang ini-specify ng Section 21 tsaka nung IRR niya is the matter of marking disease items in warrantless seizure to ensure that the evidence seized upon apprehension is the same evidence subjected to inventory and photography when these activities are undertaken at the police station rather than the place of arrest. Okay? Consistency with the chain of custody rule require na yung marking ng mga seized items to truly ensure that they are the same items na nag-enter sa chain at eventually the ones offered in evidence should be done in the presence ng apprehended violator immediately upon confiscation. Okay, remember that. This step initiates the process of protecting innocent persons from dubious and concocted searches and of protecting as well the apprehending officers from harassment suits based on planting of evidence under Section 29 and on allegations of robbery or theft. Okay. For para mas ma-specify natin yung marking, ang ibig sabihin niyan yung placing ng apprehending officer or nung nagpapanggap na buyer his initials or signature dun sa item na kinuha niya. Okay, kailangan niyang pirmahan yun. Yun yung marking. If the physical inventory and photographs are made at the nearest police station or office as allowed by the rules, the inventory and photograph of seized items must be made in accordance with Section 2 ng Board Resolution Number 1 Series of 2002. But in every case, the apprehended violator or counsel dapat present sila. Okay? Again, this is keeping in with the desired level of integrity sa pag-handle ng process na nire-require ng RA 9165. Thereafter, the seized item shall be placed sa isang envelope as an evidence bag unless yung type ng and quantity of the seized items require a different handling or container. Okay? Yung evidence bag na yan or yung container shall be accordingly signed. Okay? Mamarkahan, pipirmahan ng handling officer and turn over to the next officer in the chain of custody. Remember that. Okay, procedure and marking and sealing seized or confiscated substances. So, sa case ng People versus Habana, March 5, thoroughly discusses the proper procedure for the custody of seized or confiscated items in dangerous drugs cases in order to ensure their identity and integrity as follows. So, usually, the police officer who seizes the suspected substance turns it over to a supervising officer who would then send it by courier to the police crime laboratory for testing. Okay? Since it is unavoidable that possession of the substance changes hand a number of times, it is imperative for the police officer who seized the substance from the suspect to his place, his marking and on its plastic container and seal the same. Okay? Preferably, pang-seal niya adhesive tape that cannot be removed nang hindi masisira yung tape. Okay? So, ayun yung ginagamit na pang-seal. At the trial, the officer can then identify the seized substance and the procedure he observed to preserve its integrity until it reaches the crime laboratory. Okay? If the substance is not in a plastic container, the officer ang gagawin niya, ilalagay niya sa plastic container tapos isiselyohan niya ulit. In this way, the substance would assuredly reach the laboratory in the same condition it was seized from the accused. Further, after ma-test ng laboratory technician and verifies the nature of the substance sa container, he should put his own mark on the plastic container tapos seselyohan niya ulit with a new seal since sira na yung seal ng police officer dahil nga binuksan niya yun at tines niya, di ba? At the trial, yung technician i-describe niya yung sealed condition ng plastic container nung binigay yun sa kanya and testify on the procedure na ginawa niya to preserve its integrity. If the sealing of the seized substance has not been made, the prosecution would have to present every police officer, messenger, lahat ng technician, storage personnel, buong chain of custody. Kailangan i-present yan ng prosecution. Okay? No matter how briefly one's possession had been, kahit pa isang segundo mo lang yan nahawakan, kasama ka sa magtetestigo kung ano yung condition niya nung napunta sa'yo at nung binitawan mo. Okay? Each of them has to testify the substance, although unsealed, kahit na walang selyo, has not been tampered with or substituted while in their care. Okay? So, ayan yung procedure sa marking and sealing. Ano mangyayari pag, ayun na yung chain of custody, summary muna natin. So, summary ng chain of custody requirement, ulitin lang ulit natin. Summary niya. So, immediately after seizure and confiscation, yung apprehending officer, magkakandak kagad siya ng physical inventory and photograph nung seized substance kung saan niya sinerve yung search warrant niya. Or kung warrantless naman yan, nearest police station or nearest office ng apprehending officer or apprehending team. Okay? Yung physical inventory na yun and photograph should be made in the presence ng elected public official, nung accused mismo or persons kung kanino man na confiscate yan or representative niya or counsel and representative ng National Prosecution Service or the media. Laging tatlo. Okay? Three witness rule lang tawag natin dyan. Hindi pwedeng maano yan. May exemptions pero later on. Sige. Yung witnesses na yan should sign the copies of the inventory and be given a copy thereof. Okay? Tapos yung seized substance na yan should be placed sa isang plastic container. Tapos yung apprehending officer, lalagyan niya ng marking niya, okay, in the container, tapos isi-seal niya ng, sabi natin, adhesive tape. Yung hindi pwedeng ma-remove without leaving a tear o kaya scar dun sa plastic container. Okay? Yung marked evidence niya must be turned over by the apprehending officer to the investigating officer. After nun, yung investigating officer, dadalhin yan sa PDEA Forensic Laboratory for examination within 24 hours from confiscation. Okay. After testing ng substance, itong crime laboratory, yung technician nila, lalagyan niya ng mark sa plastic container, si-seal niya ulit ng bagong seal. Okay. Yung forensic chemist na yan, syempre, i-certify niyan under oath. Tapos, ita-turn over and submit the marked illegal drug sa korte. Okay? So, that is the summary of the chain of custody requirement. So, ano mangyayari pag hindi sinunod yan, yung chain of custody na yan? Sabihin natin, walang physical inventory and photographs na nangyari. Anong mangyayari? So, the records do not show that the procedure, okay, the procedural requirements ng Section 21 with respect to the custody and disposition of confiscated drugs were followed. So, walang physical inventory and photographs na nakuha. Okay? On that score alone, the case for the prosecution fails. Acquitted kagad yan. Kasi absent yung plausible explanation to justify yung failure to comply with the requirement. Okay? Example, sa isang case, yung chain of custody nasira after SPO2 Dionco failed to mark the first sachet, nakalimutan yung markahan, which is the subject of the sale and the subject of the information. Okay? Yung sachet na yon together with two others was delivered sa PNP Crime Lab after more than 8 hours from the initial custody of the apprehending officer was not even explained. Okay? So, sira ang chain of custody. Sa case ni People versus Santos, yung police officers, yung members ng Bybus team, cannot bank on the presumption of regularity in the performance of their duties. Okay? Hindi nila pwedeng gawing defense yun, yung presumption of regularity. Why? Because nasira na yung presumption na yun nung hindi nila pinicturan yung evidence ng walang justifiable reason. Okay? Ano naman mangyayari pag walang marking in the presence of the accused or counsel? Okay, let's take a look at the case of Carino versus People. So, si Atienza, Piotr Atienza, nag-testify siya na kinonfiscate niya yung prohibited drug and dinala niya yun sa office niya. Okay? So, he then prepared the request and only then in his office, dun niya lang nilagyan ng initials niya, yung plastic sachet sa office niya na. Okay? So, the prosecution failed to establish that the petitioner, yung accused, was present when nung minamarkahan ng pulis yung plastic sachet. So, dahil doon nasira yung chain of custody, na-acquit yung accused. Maliit na pagkakamali. Ano naman mangyari pag walang evidence of authorship of markings? Walang pirma. Okay. So, sa case ng People versus Gayoso, ganyan yung nangyari. Si PO2 Isip, nag-testify siya na yung mga shabu were marked in the police station. Okay? Pero, walang evidence to present na yung marking na yun, eh, ginawa yun sa presence nung kinuhanan. Sabi natin sa rule kanina, 3-witness rule, di ba? Kailangan na andun yung apelan. Moreover, yung author ng markings, hindi na-identify kung sino. Okay? Walang police officer na umaamin na sa kanila yung pirma na yun. So, there was, therefore, a complete absence of evidence to prove the authorship of the markings. Hindi natin alam sinong nagmarka nun. So, acquitted. Okay? Ano naman mangyayari pag walang evidence on how this item changed hands? Hindi, walang evidence kung paano lumipat-lipat yung this items na yan, kung kani-kanino. So, sa case ng People versus Havana, yung prosecution failed to show that the this item changed hands mula nung kinuha yan ng police officer from Havana to the time that they were presented in court as evidence. Wala silang mapakitang record sinong mga humawak niyan. So, sabi ni PO1 Paras, he turned over the sachets of shabu dun sa investigator. Okay? Pero yung prosecution did not adduce evidence on what the investigator on duty did with the seized articles. Okay? Kung paano niya ito dinala sa laboratory technician, kung paano siya sinafe keeping while being adduced in evidence at the trial, walang record na ganun. So, since yung failure to comply with the procedure ng chain of custody, naka-apekto sa integrity ng item, which is the corpus delicti of each of the crimes charged against Habana. So, ang nangyari, na-acquit siya dahil hindi sumunod sa chain of custody. Okay? Ganyan ka-importante ang chain of custody. Remember that non-compliance with chain of custody, okay, which is in section 21 ng IRR ng RA 9115, particularly the marking of the inventory and photographing ng drugs, will not render the drugs inadmissible as evidence. Okay? What is imperative ay yung preservation ng integrity and the evidential value of the seized items, and the same would be utilized in the determination of guilt or innocence of the accused. Yung last paragraph ng Section 21, Article 2 ng IRR niyan, provides a saving mechanism to ensure na hindi lahat ng case ng non-compliance ay magiging prejudice sa prosecution case. So, to warrant an application of the saving mechanism, however, the prosecution must recognize and explain the lapse or the lapses in the prescribed procedure. Okay? The prosecution must likewise demonstrate that the integrity and yung evidentiary value of the evidences have been preserved. Okay? So, hindi naman porket hindi talaga nakasunod, sira na kagad. Merong saving. But, yun nga, kailangan i-demonstrate ng prosecution yung integrity and evidentiary value of evidence na na-preserve siya. Kailangan patunayan na na-preserve. Kasi kung hindi mapapatunayan na na-preserve yan dahil nga sinira mo yung chain of custody, then the acquittal of the accused is in order. We have mentioned earlier yung 3-witness rule. Okay? Sa gagawin mo yung marking na yan sa harap ng accused, representative niya, counsel niya, okay, o kung kanino mo man nakuha yan. Tapos, elected public official and representative ng National Prosecution Office or media. Okay? Ito yung tinatawag natin na three witness rule. Okay? But merong mga instances na pwede ma-excuse or ma-justify yung non-compliance sa three witness rule, such as yung attendance nila was impossible because the place of arrest nasa remote area. Wala tayong mahanap na media o walang mahanap na representative ng National Prosecution, ba? Pangalawa, their safety during the inventory and photograph of the seized drugs was threatened by an immediate retaliatory action of the accused or any person acting for in his or her behalf. Okay? Nag-bypass operation ka dun sa den nila. So, hindi mo alam ano pala, delikado dun dahil nandun pa yung mga kasama niya eh. Nagtatago lang pala. Tapos ikaw, picture ka lang ng picture dun. Nagtawag ka pa ng kung sino-sino para maging witness. Okay. So, merong immediate danger. So, yung pangatlo is elected officials themselves. Involved sila ron sa mga punishable acts sought to be apprehended. Okay? Kung sila mismo yung mga elected officials mismo yung ano, yung merong kasalanan. So, hindi sila pwede maging witness. Earnest effort to secure the presence of the DOJ or media representative and an elected public official within the period required under the Article 125 of the Revised Penal Code. Okay, lalampas na dun sa 12.18.36, hindi pa dumarating yung ano, yung tinawag mong DOJ or media. So, makakasuhan ka na ng arbitrary detention, di ba? So, futile pero hindi fault ng arresting officer kasi they are facing the threat of being charged with arbitrary detention. And panglima, yung time constraints and the urgency of the anti-drug operations which often relies on theft of confidential assets prevented the law enforcers from obtaining the presence of the required witnesses before the offenders could escape. Okay. So, that is the five exemptions to the three witness rule. Okay. So, what happens for the failure to turn over the laboratory within 24 hours from seizure? So, kung yung police officer, hindi niya turn over yung dangerous drugs sa laboratory within 24 hours, okay, kailangan i-identify nila sino yung custodian, sino yung may hawak, sino yung nagtago. Okay? And yung custodian na yan, tatawagin yan to testify. The custodian must state the security measure na ginawa niya to ensure the integrity and evidentiary value of the confiscated items na na-preserve talaga. Okay? Okay, so mandatory policy regarding compliance with requirements of Section 21 of RA 9165. So, the Supreme Court expressly required the apprehending officer to state dun sa sworn statement nila of compliance with the requirements ng chain of custody. Or in case of non-observance, i-state nila yung justification nila kung bakit. And is the steps taken to preserve the integrity and evidentiary rule on these items. Okay? Kailangan i-state nila yung justification nila. So, the Supreme Court held, in order to weed out early on the courts from the courts already congested docket, any orchestrated or poorly built drug-related cases, the following should be enforced as a mandatory policy. So, sa sworn statement ng affidavits, kailangan i-state nila yung compliance nila sa chain of custody. Okay? Kung hindi nila na observe, nasira nila yung chain of custody, kailangan i-state nila rin sa sworn statement nila yung justification kung bakit hindi nila nasunod. And kung ano yung mga steps na ginawa nila to preserve the integrity and evidentiary value of the seized evidence. Kung walang justification or explanation na dineclare sa sworn affidavit, yung fiscal must not immediately file the case before the court. Okay? Instead, ang gagawin niya, i-refer niya for further preliminary investigation in order to determine the existence or non-existence ng probable cause. Okay? So, kung si investigating fiscal, nag-file na siya kahit na hindi nasunod yung chain of custody or walang justification, the court may exercise its discretion to either refuse to issue a commitment order or warrant of arrest, or pwede niyang i-dismiss yung case outright for lack of probable cause in accordance with Section 5, Rule 112 ng Rules of Court. Okay? Regarding sa coordination ng bypass operation sa PDEA ng PNP, hindi naman to indispensable requirement. Okay? Hindi siya sine qua non requirement. So, yung coordination with the PDEA is not an indispensable requirement before police authority may carry out bypass operation. Okay? While it is true na yung Section 86 ng 9165 requires the NBI, the PNP, the Bureau of Customs maintains a close coordination with the PDEA in all drug-related cases. Okay? Close coordination. The provision does not, by so saying, yung participation mismo ng PDEA indispensable, na dapat kasama sila for every bypass operation. Pero kailangan merong coordination. Okay? Kasi kung walang coordination, mga magbabarilan na naman yan sa ano, sa Commonwealth. Diba? After all kasi, yung bypass is just a form of in flagrante delicto arrest na sanction naman ng rules of court natin, which police authorities may rightfully resort to apprehending violators ng RA 9165 in support of the PDEA. Okay? So, a bypass operation is not invalidated by a mere non-coordination with the PDEA. Okay? Hindi pwedeng sabihin na hindi valid yung bypass operation porket hindi nakipag-coordinate sa PDEA. Pero mas maganda pa rin makipag-coordinate, syempre, para hindi magbarilan sa Commonwealth. Pero hindi natin pwedeng sabihin na hindi valid yung bypass operation dahil walang coordination. Hindi pwede yun. Okay? It is within the authority of the police officer na mag-conduct ng bypass operation. Okay? As an in flagranto delicto arrest. As sanction ng Section 5, Paragraph A, Rule 113 ng Rules of Court. Okay, let's talk about the other persons liable. Bukod sa mga na-discuss natin kanina, sino pa mga liable? Of course, yung financer and yung protector. Pag sinabing financer, sila yung nagbabayad, nagre-raise, nagsusupply ng pera, or underwrites any illegal activities prescribed under RA 9165. Yung mga activities na diniscuss natin kanina, sila yung nagbabayad, sila yung nagsusupply ng pera, sila yung financer. Liable din sila. Okay? Yung protector or cuddler. Okay? Etong any person who knowingly and willfully consents to the unlawful acts na diniscuss natin kanina and ginamit niya yung influence niya, yung power niya, yung position niya, okay, para maprotektahan kayo, maharbor kayo, or matulungan kayo makatakas sa authorities of any person na he knows or has reasonable grounds to believe or suspects na nakapag-violate siya ng provisions ng RA 9165 in order to prevent arrest, prosecution, conviction of the violator. So that is protector. Okay? Ano rin sila? Liable din sila under RA 9165. Okay? So syempre, let's talk about penalties. Penalties para sa mga unlawful acts na dinadiscuss natin. So, penalty ay, well, first is yung death. Life imprisonment na siya ngayon by virtue of RA 9346. Okay? So, any person who is found guilty of planting, mamaya na yan. Basta, remember, yung death, wala na siya. Life imprisonment na yan. Okay? By virtue of 9346 na sinuspend yung death penalty, and in lieu of death penalty, the penalty should be provided is reclusion perpetua or life imprisonment. So, death. Ngayon, life imprisonment na siya. And fine ranging from 500,000 to 10 million pesos. Okay. Yung mga maintainer, owner, operator ng drug den, dive, and resort. Okay. Should any dangerous drugs be the proximate cause of the death of a person using the same in drug den, dive, or resort? Okay. Ikaw yung nagme-maintain ng drug den na yan, tapos yung gumagamit sa drug den na yan, eh namatay dahil dun sa drugs. So, ang penalty mo, death or life imprisonment, and a fine ranging from 500,000 to 10 million. Death naman, death, walang fine. Death is, ito ang imprisonment ng taong mafa-found of guilty ng planting. Okay, nagtatanim ng dangerous drugs or controlled precursor and essential elements, regardless of the quantity and purity. They shall suffer the penalty of death. That's section 29. Yung planting of evidence, ito yung willful act by any person of maliciously and surreptitiously inserting, placing, adding, attaching directly or indirectly through overt acts or covert acts, whatever quantity of any dangerous drugs or controlled precursor and essential elements in the person, house, effects, or the immediate vicinity of an innocent individual, para lang ma-implicate siya, para ma-incriminate siya, para ma-impute siya of the commission of any violation ng RA 9165. That's planting. Nagtanim ka ng ebidensya para mapagbintangan siya or ma-aresto siya or ma-prosecute siya, ma-implicate siya, ma-incriminate siya. Okay? So, nagplant ka. Penalty of life imprisonment to death, okay, pero wala na yung death ngayon, and a fine ranging from 500,000 to 10 million. Yung mga acts na ito, importation ng dangerous drug, section 4, okay, STADDT ng mga dangerous drugs or acting as a broker, section 5, okay, maintenance of a drug den, dive, resort where any dangerous drugs is being used or sold, section 6. Manufacture ng dangerous drugs, section 8. Section 16, yung cultivation or culture plants classified as dangerous drugs. Unlawful prescription of dangerous drugs, section 19. A public officer na nag-misappropriate, misapply, or fails to account the for confiscated, seized, surrendered dangerous drugs, plant sources, controlled precursor, instruments, paraphernalia, including the proceeds of the properties obtained from unlawful acts. Yung hindi sumunod sa chain of custody. Okay? Napatunayan na sinadya na talaga na hindi sumunod sa chain of custody. That's violation of section 27 na may penalty na life imprisonment to death and a fine ranging from 100,000 to 10 million. Okay? Hindi 10,000. Sorry. Typo lang. So, yan yung mga penalty na yan yung penalty sa mga acts na yan. Penalty naman ng imprisonment ranging from 12 years to 1 day. Ay, balik pala tayo, right? Death. Bailable? Hindi bailable. So, hindi bailable yan. Ito, bailable ba yung maintainer? Hindi. Hindi rin bailable yan. Tandaan, bail is a matter of right unless the punishment is life, imprisonment, reclusion perpetua, or death. So, kapag ganun, then bail becomes a matter of discretion by the court. And pwedeng mag-grant yan, pwedeng mag-grant if the evidence against you is not strong. Evidence of guilt is not strong. Pero generally, non-bailable na yan. Okay, ito, syempre, death penalty, life imprisonment, non-bailable. Itong mga ito, non-bailable. Non-bailable ka na, hindi ka pa pwede mag-apply ng probation dahil 6 years lang ang probation. Okay, imprisonment of 12 years and 1 day to 20 years and a fine ranging from 100,000 to 500,000. Yan yung penalty ng mga sumusunod. Section 4. Okay? Section 5, Section 6, Section 7. Yung Section 7 yung employee lang ng Dragden Diver Resort who is aware of the nature of the place of such. Isaac, yung bumisita sa Dragden, kahit alam niyan Dragden yon. Yan din yan. Unauthorized manufacture or of controlled precursor or essential chemicals. Illegal chemical diversion, section 9. Okay, manufacture or delivery ng equipment or other paraphernalia, section 10. Unnecessary prescription, ha? Unnecessary, hindi unlawful. Unnecessary prescription of dangerous drugs by a practitioner, section 18. Protector, cuddler na mga ito, sumusunod yung importer ng dangerous drugs, STADDDRT ng mga control precursor, section 5. Maintenance ng drug den, section 6, section 8, section 16, yung mga protector and cuddler niyan. So also suffers a penalty of imprisonment ranging from 12 years and 1 day to 20 years and a fine ranging from 100,000 to 500,000. Okay. Maximum penalty imposed sa mga violators ng importation ng dangerous drugs sa section 4. Through the use of diplomatic passport o kaya yung diplomatic facilities or any other means involving his or her official status intended to facilitate the unlawful entry of the same. Ginamit niya yung status niya para maipasok dito yung dangerous drugs, control precursor, and essential elements. So kapag ganon, maximum penalty shall be imposed. Okay, STADDDRT ng mga dangerous drugs or precursor transpire within 100 meters from the school. Okay, 100 meters. Maximum penalty. Yung mga drug pusher na gumagamit ng minor or mentally incapacitated as runner, courier nila, messenger nila, or in any other capacity directly connected to the dangerous drugs or controlled precursor and essential chemical trade. Okay? Maximum penalty rin. Sa section 6 naman, kung yung mga inadminister na drug, binenta, binenta yan sa minor. Tapos yung minor, pinayagan mo pang gumamit ng drug din or resort. Okay? So, maximum penalty pa rin. Kung yung victim of the offense is a minor or mentally incapacitated, okay? O kaya namatay yung bata na yan and yung proximate cause ng pagkakamatay niya dahil sa drugs mo, maximum penalty. Okay? Paggamit ng minor or mentally incapacitated individual para mag-deliver ng equipment under section 10, maximum penalty. Okay? Kung yung land involved sa cultivation o pagpa-plant ng ano, mga dangerous drug, part ng public domain. Yung pinagtaniman mo ng ano, halaman mo. So, maximum penalty. And organizer, financer, manager ng section 4, section 5, parang nabanggit natin kanina, section 6, section 8, section 16. Okay, kanina kasi yung protector and cuddler na itong mga to. Yung 12 years and 1 day to 20 years. Okay, dito naman yung organizer, manager, or financer. Maximum penalty ang impose sa kanila. And of course, yung mga found guilty of unlawful acts, government official sila and employee, aside from perpetual disqualification, maximum penalty to be imposed. Okay? Under section 28. Okay, the penalty of imprisonment ng 1 year, 1 day to 6 years and a fine ranging from 10,000 to 50,000, which is bailable to. Okay? Yung kanina rin bailable, 12 years, 1 day. Pero ito, pwede ka mag-apply for probation. So, ayan yung penalty ng mga practitioner, manufacturer, wholesaler, importer, distributor. Okay, hindi natin nailagay dyan sa slide. Basta, 1 year, 1 day to 6 years, and a fine ranging from 10,000 to 50,000. Practitioner, manufacturer, wholesaler, importer, distributor, dealer, retailer who violates or fails to comply with the maintenance and keeping of the original records of transactions of any dangerous drugs or controlled precursor and essential chemical. So, imprisonment naman ng 6 months and 1 day to 4 years, bailable to and pwede mag-apply ng probation, and a fine ranging from 10,000 to 50,000 yung mga nag-manufacture, nag-deliver na equipment, instrument, apparatus, and other paraphernalia for dangerous drugs and or controlled precursors and essential chemicals if it will be used to ingest, inject, inhale, or otherwise introduce into the human body a dangerous drugs provided under Section 10. Okay. Penalties naman for the possession or use ng dangerous drugs. Doon muna tayo sa possession. So, life imprisonment to death and a fine ranging from 500,000 to 10 million shall be imposed upon any person who, unless authorized by law, shall possess any dangerous drugs sa mga quantities na ito, regardless of purity. Regardless of purity, mamaya yung 10 grams na yan, yung 5 grams pala dyan, tawas lang. Pero magkahalo sila. So, ika-count yun as 10 grams. Okay? Regardless of purity. So, 10 grams or more ng opium, morphine, heroin, cocaine, cocaine hydrochloride, marijuana resin oil, or other dangerous drugs such as, but not limited to, methylene dioxymethamphetamine or yung MDMA, yung ecstasy, paramecetoxyamphetamine, yung PMA, o kaya trimethoxymethamphetamine, yung TMA, lysergic acid, LSD, gamma hydroxy butyrate, yung GHB, and those similarly designed or newly introduced drugs and their derivative na wala namang therapeutic value or quantity possessed is far beyond therapeutic requirements. So, yan, 10 grams lang ng mga yan. Life imprisonment to death na. And 500K to 10 million fine. Okay, ano pa? 50 grams or more ng shabu. Okay, 50 grams or more. Yan yung penalty mo. Non-bailable, non-probationable. Okay? Or 500 grams or more of marijuana. Okay? Paano kung hindi umabot yan? Ibig sabihin ba, exempted ka? 9 grams lang yung ano mo, marijuana resin mo. Okay? 40 grams lang yung shabu mo. 400 grams lang yung marijuana mo. Ibig sabihin ba, exempted ka? Hindi. Meron corresponding penalties yan. Sinabi lang, ito yung kailangan na quantity para makamit mo yung maximum penalty for possession. Okay? So, kapag mas mababa, life imprisonment, tapos bababa yung fine ng 400 to 500,000 kung yung shabu 10 grams or more pero less than 50 grams. Kanina kasi 50 grams yung shabu, di ba? Okay? Ngayon, 10 grams or more pero less than 50. Imprisonment naman ng 20 years and 1 day to life imprisonment in a fine ranging from 400,000 to 500,000. Kung yung quantities na nabanggit ko kanina na mahirap banggapin, yung mga opium, morphine, MDMA, ecstasy, less than 10 grams. Okay? Pero more than 5 grams. So, 5 to 10. So, imprisonment naman ng 12 years, 1 day, and 20 years and a fine ranging from 300 to 400,000. Bailable na, non-probationable pa rin. If yung quantities is less than 5 grams ng opium, okay? So, or less than 300 grams ng marijuana. So, kahit pa isang gramo lang yan ng marijuana, hindi ka exempted, may penalty ka pa rin, okay? Nag-iiba-iba lang yung penalty regardless kung gaano kadami yung na confiscate sa iyo, na seize sa iyo na drugs. Pero regardless of purity yan. Okay? Tinitimbang yan kahit patawas yan. basta nakahalo yan sa drugs mo. Okay, paano naman sa possession ng equipment? Okay, kanina possession ng dangerous drugs. Sa possession naman ng equipment, imprisonment ranging from 6 months and 1 day to 4 years. Okay, bailable, probationable, and the fine ranging 10,000 to 50,000. But take note that maximum penalty shall be imposed for possession of equipment, instrument, apparatus na dinala mo siya sa mga social gatherings, parties, meetings, or in the proximate company of at least 2 persons. Okay. Yan yung penalty mo. Sa use naman, paggamit, first offense, yung person apprehended or arrested who is found positive for the use of any dangerous drugs, after matest siya at mag-positive, okay, shall be imposed a penalty of minimum of 6 months rehabilitation sa isang government center. Okay, na-discuss ko kanina bakit mababa yung use sa first offense dahil nga victim sila. Okay? Ang predator dito yung mga nagbebenta. Pero, syempre, pag nag-second offense na yan, hindi na sila victim yan. So, second offense is imprisonment na yan, ranging from 6 years and 1 day, non-probationable na yan, to 12 years, and a fine ranging from 50,000 to 200,000. Okay? Bukod doon, ano yung mga civil penalties nila? So, we all learn sa book 1, bukod sa imprisonment, meron pang mga accessory penalties bukod sa principal penalties. So, ano yung mga accessory penalties nila? So, disqualification from exercising civil rights under Section 35. So, a person na convicted sa act na ito, disqualified na siya na i-exercise yung mga civil rights niya. Such as, yung parental authority or guardianship niya as to the person or property of any ward, yung right niya to dispose ng property na yun by any act or any conveyance, inter vivos, and political rights niya, yung right to vote, right niya na iboto siya. Okay, such rights shall be suspended during the pendency of an appeal from such conviction. Ayan pa, cancellation ng diplomatic passport niya. Okay, kung naka-violate yan nung diniscuss natin kanina, Section 4, importation. Nag-import siya dito, tapos ginamit niya yung status niya, yung official status niya, para makapag-import siya. Then, ika-cancel yung diplomatic passport niya. Iko-confiscate and ika-cancel. Confiscation of and escheat of property used as a drug den dive or resort. Siyempre, iko-confiscate yung ginamit yung drug din na yan, in favor of the government, provided that the criminal complaint shall specifically allege that such place is intentionally used in the furtherance of the crime. Okay? Provided further that yung prosecution shall prove such intent on the part of the owner to use the property for such purpose. And provided finally that the owner shall be included as an accused in the criminal complaint. Okay? So, kung hindi naman, di, bahala na. Ano pa, pang-apat is confiscation and escheat of land kung saan nag-cultivate or nag-culture. Ganon din, in favor of the state, kukunin din yung land na yan under Section 16. Revocation of license kapag sa mga case yan ng practitioner, businessman, in case of manufacturer, seller, importer, distributor, dealer, retailer who violates or fails to comply sa maintenance and keeping ng original records or transactions ng mga dangerous drugs and controlled precursor and essential chemical. Siyempre, meron mga legit na nagbebenta ng mga essential chemical dito kasi ginagamit yan sa legit na gamot natin. So, yung mga taong yan, kung nagbenta yan sa mga illegal pusher or yung illegal laboratories, then mare-revocate yung license nila. Ano pa? confiscation and forfeiture of the proceeds of the or the instrument of the unlawful act. Okay, every penalty, remember, to be imposed for unlawful importation, sale, trading, administration, dispensation, delivery, distribution, transportation, or manufacture ng dangerous drugs or controlled precursor and essential chemical. Ganon din sa cultivation and culture of plants. Okay? Siyempre, ikaw confiscate yung mga yan. Hindi yan babalik. Pag yung guilt ng accused, may tanong, paano kung acquitted yung accused? Ibabalik ba sa kanya mga illegal na kinuha? Siyempre, hindi. Okay? Where the guilt of the accused was not proven beyond reasonable doubt, then it follows that the seized item which do not constitute illegal or prohibited drugs, pwedeng ibalik sa kanya. Pero yung mga drugs na yan, yung mga inherently illegal, sisirain yan. Okay? Ide-destroy yan ng government. Pero yung mga proceeds niyan, like may nakuhang evidence na cellphone o kaya motor na ginamit sa escape, na-acquit si accused. Hindi naman illegal ang cellphone, hindi naman illegal ang motor. So, ibabalik sa kanya. Hindi pwedeng i-confiscate yan and forfeit in favor of the government. Okay? Such disposition can only be made kapag na-convict yung accused. Okay? Pero yung mga illegal drugs, i-confiscate yan. Sisirain yan, syempre. Disqualification from public office. Ng public officer or employee na misappropriate, misapply, mali yung pagkaka-confiscate, seize, or surrender drugs, nagplant siya ng sources of drugs, mga control precursor, essential chemicals, essentially, hindi sumunod sa chain of custody. Okay? So, pre, madi-disqualified yan. Removal and perpetual disqualification, Section 27. So, any elected official or national official found to have benefited from the proceeds of the trafficking of dangerous drugs or to have received any financial or material contribution or donation from natural or juridical person found guilty of trafficking dangerous drugs shall be removed from office and perpetually disqualified from holding any elective or appointed positions sa government. Okay, bawal silang tumakbo. That is Section 27. And last na additional penalty ay deportation after service of sentence. Kapag alien yung naka-violate niyan, syempre, kulong muna yan dito. After makulong dito, pag nakalayaman, if ever, i-deport yan without further proceedings. Okay? Unless the penalty is death. Or, syempre, life imprisonment. Unless na magkaroon ng usapan yung dalawang bansa. Okay? Take note that drug traffickers and pusher may not apply for probation. Bakit? Because mas mataas sa 6 years yung nila. Okay, mas mataas sa 6 years yung penalty nila. Alam na natin sa PD 968, 6 years and below. So, any person convicted for drug trafficking or pushing under this act, regardless of the penalty imposed, cannot be availed the privilege granted by probation law PD 968 as amended. Okay? Pero pagdating sa drug trafficking, saka sa pusher, kahit pa 2 taon lang yan, hindi ka pwede mag-apply ng probation dahil specifically provided sa PD 968 na bawal mag-apply ng probation ang drug trafficker at drug pusher. Okay? Probation. Okay? Okay, we have learned from book 1, syempre, ang attempted, mas mababa ang penalty niyan kasi sa consummated, but may mga exemption yan. Okay? So, attempt or conspiracy penalized with the same penalty as consummated act. Sa mga following, yung importation of any dangerous drugs or precursor tsaka chemical, okay, STA, DDDR, DDTT ng mga dangerous drugs, controlled precursor, and essential chemical, maintenance ng den dive or resort where any dangerous drugs is used in any form, manufacture of any dangerous drugs and or controlled precursor and essential chemical, and cultivation or culture of plants which are sources of dangerous drugs. So, let's talk about the criminal liability of officers of juridical entities. So, meron kasing dalawang types ng person sa batas natin. We have natural person and juridical person. Okay? Natural person tayo yun. May mga karapatan tayo. Okay? Juridical person, yan yung mga corporation, mga kumpanya. Considered sila as person but wala silang vested rights. Okay? So, in case of any violation of this act, eh, committed yan ng partnership, corporation, association, or any juridical entity, yung partner, president niyan, yung director niyan, manager, trustee, estate administrator, or officer who consents or knowingly tolerates such violation shall be held criminally liable as co-principal. Okay, yung mga officer ng juridical entities. President, yung mga binanggit dyan. Okay? The penalty provided for the offense under this act shall be imposed doon sa partner, sa president, sa director, manager, trustee, okay, who knowingly authorizes, tolerates, or consents yung paggamit ng vehicle nila, ng aircraft nila, equipment nila, or other facility nila as instrument para makapag-import, makapag-benta, makapag-trade, makapag-administer, makapag-dispense, makapag-deliver, makapag-distribute, makapag-transport or manufacture ng dangerous drugs or chemical diversion if such vehicle, vessel, aircraft equipment, or other instrument is owned or under control or supervision ng partnership na yun, corporation, association, or juridical entity to which they are affiliated. Okay, kung yung juridical entity na yan, sila yung nagmamay-ari ng mga equipment na yan or mga facilities na ginamit mo, mga sasakyan na ginamit mo. So, yung president nila, yung officer, kung sino mang may alam ng kalokohan na yan, sila yung magiging liable as co-principal. Okay. Let's move on to plea bargaining. Okay, dati sabi nila, bawal daw ang plea bargaining. When you say plea bargaining, ito yung makikipag-usap ka sa prosecutor, okay, na babaan yung sentence mo. Aamin ka sa mas mababang sentence. Okay. Pinapayagan yung ganito para hindi na dumaan pa sa trial, hindi na mahirapan pa yung korte, mas mapabilis yung process. Umamin ka na lang sa mas mababang offense. Pinapayagan yan. That is plea bargaining. So, dati, sabi nila, bawal daw ang plea bargaining sa drug cases. Bawal daw. But, sa case ni Estepona versus Lobrigo, sabi ng court, unconstitutional yung Section 23 na nagpro-prohibit ng plea bargaining in drug cases. So, bawal daw yan, sabi ng court. Okay? Sabi ng court, yung power to promulgate rules ng pleading practice and procedure, exclusively belongs yan sa Supreme Court. Okay? Supreme Court yung may power ng procedure making. So, hindi pwede mag-implement ng batas itong legislative na sasakupin mo or gagawin mo yung trabaho ng korte. Okay? Sila yung may karapatan mag-establish ng procedure. So, bawal si legislative na sabihin na, yung mga ganitong kaso, bawal pre-bargaining. Bakit? Sino ka? Hindi naman ikaw yung Supreme Court. Bakit ikaw nagde-decide na bawal ang pre-bargaining dyan? Okay? Since bargaining, pre-bargaining, rule of procedure yan. So, walang authority si Congress na i-repeal, i-alter, or supplement such procedural rule. Okay? Yung adoption of plea bargaining framework in drug cases, yung administrative number 18316 SC, sets forth the acceptable plea bargaining in drug cases. Okay? So, yung pag ang offense charge, section violation ng section 11, possession ng dangerous drugs na less than 5 grams lang yung shabu, opium, morphine, heroin, cocaine, or less than 300 grams sa marijuana, ang acceptable plea bargaining natin dyan, pwede kang umamin na lang sa possession of drug paraphernalia. Doon ka na lang aamin. Which is mas mababang penalty. Okay? Pag yung possession mo naman, 5 grams or more na cocaine, shabu, opium, pero hindi lalampas ng 10 grams, or 300 or more na marijuana, pero hindi lalampas ng 500, pwede ka mag-plea bargain at umamin sa possession of dangerous drugs. Itong nasa taas naman. Itong nasa taas niya. So, syempre, mas mababa pa rin yung penalty nito kaysa dito. Okay? So, amin ka na lang dito. That is plea bargaining. Kapag ito naman, possession naman, okay, possession ng equipment, apparatus, and other paraphernalia for dangerous drugs, ang acceptable plea bargaining niyan is amin ka sa use of dangerous drugs. Okay? Use, remember kanina, first offense, 6 months na rehabilitation sa government facility. Okay, amin ka na lang dyan. Kapag ang charge naman sa iyo ay Section 5, sale trading ng methamphetamine or shabu or marijuana only, yan dalawa lang, pwede kang mag-plea into possession of drug paraphernalia, which is mas mababang penalty. Okay? So, ito yung rule natin sa plea bargaining. Take note na yung ano, in all other cases na ang imposable penalty ay life, imprisonment to death, okay, bargaining is not allowed. Okay? Plea bargaining is not allowed under Section 5, yung sale trading ng dangerous drugs, involving all other kinds of dangerous drugs. Tingnan mo, nakalagay lang natin dito yung shabu lang or marijuana yung pwedeng i-plea bargaining into possession ng drug paraphernalia. Pero yung other napakaraming drugs na minention natin kanina, hindi naman kasama rito. Okay, like yung morphine, wala naman dito. So, bawal ang plea bargaining sa ganong situation. Okay, programs for drug dependents. Kapag itong dalawa yung program, for voluntary submission tsaka compulsory confinement. Okay, so voluntary submission, kusa kang nag-submit, subject dyan is application for voluntary submission for treatment and rehabilitation ng drug dependency. Sinong pwede mag-apply? Yung drug dependent or drug user. Okay? Kung incapacitated siya or minor siya, pwede yung parent niya. Okay? Or pwede yung spouse, guardian, or relative within the fourth degree of consanguinity or affinity. So, ang procedure natin dyan, mag-i-issue ng yung physician ng DOH accredited. Mag-i-issue siya ng application na itong applicant is drug dependent. Okay? And he shall be ordered by the court na mag-undergo ng treatment and rehabilitation sa isang board-designated center for a period of not less than 6 months. Okay? Okay, ibibigay siya sa under the care of DOH accredited physician kung walang center na malapit or accessible sa residence ng drug dependent, or yung drug dependent is below 18 years of age, tapos first time offender lang naman. And yung non-confinement niya, hindi naman magpo-pose ng danger sa sarili niya, sa community niya, or sa family niya. Okay? Yung confinement sa isang center for treatment and rehabilitation, hindi dapat yan lalampas ng 1 year. Okay? After which time, the court and the board shall be apprised by the head of the center of the status of said drug dependent and determine whether further confinement will be for the welfare of the drug dependent and his family or the community. Okay? Exemption from criminal liability. Exemption from criminal liability. So, yung drug dependent under voluntary submission program na na-discharge na from confinement, except na siya sa criminal liability for drug use. Okay? Pero may condition yan, syempre. Yung compliance with the rules and regulation ng center and of the board, including aftercare and follow-up program for at least 6 months following temporary discharge from confinement. Okay? For a dependent placed under the care of ng physician, yung compliance with the aftercare for program and follow-up schedule formulated by the DSWD and approved by board. Okay? And yung drug dependent should never been charged or convicted ng any offense punishable under RA 9165, 6425, RPC, or any special law. Okay? Yung drug dependent, wala dapat siyang record na tumakas siya from a center. If tumakas man siya, nag-surrender naman siya through his parent, through herself, his spouse niya, guardian niya, relatives niya within 4th degree of consanguinity or affinity within 1 week from the date na tumakas siya. Okay? And yung dependent poses no serious danger sa sarili niya, sa pamilya niya, sa community niya by his exemption from criminal liability. Okay? So kapag nasunod niya yung mga condition na yan, hindi na siya kakasuhan for drug use. So, paano ang filing of charges against a drug dependent who is not rehabilitated? So, a drug dependent who is not rehabilitated after a second commitment to the center shall, upon recommendation ng board, be charged with violation ng Section 15, drug use, and prosecuted like any other offender. Kapag na-convict siya, ike-credit yung period niya ng confinement sa rehabilitation center. In the service of his sentence, ibabawas doon. Okay? So, that is voluntary submission. Pagdating naman sa compulsory confinement, syempre, wala tayong involuntary submission. Okay? Ito, mandatory confinement to kapag na-found ka na guilty. Tapos, hindi ka naman nag-voluntary surrender. So, anong subject dito? Yung petition for compulsory confinement of a drug dependent. Anong coverage? Yung accused charged with an offense where the imposable penalty is less than 6 years and 1 day. Remember, 6 years and 1 day. So, yung mga mas mataas dyan, hindi sila pwede sa mga programs for drug dependents. Sino pwede mag-file? Yung Dangerous Drugs Board or any of its authorized representatives. Saan nila ipa-file? Sa RTC of the province or city kung saan nasaan yung drug dependent, saan nakita. Okay? So, ang procedure natin dyan, if yung accused is found by the prosecutor or court to be drug dependent, yung proceeding shall be suspended and records forwarded to the board. Okay? If yung public interest requires commitment of the accused to the center, magfa-file ng petition si board with the court for compulsory confinement. The court shall immediately issue an order fixing the petition for hearing. Tapos, si court shall order the drug dependent to be examined by 2 board-accredited physicians. After ma-conclude ng physicians na yun yung examine nila, ide-determine nila kung si respondent ba ay drug dependent or hindi. Kung hindi siya drug dependent, i-discharge na siya ng court. Okay? Pero kung dependent siya, magkakandak na ng hearing yung court. If yung court naman na pag-alaman niya na drug dependent to, mag-i-issue na siya ng order for his confinement to treatment and rehabilitation center under the supervision ng DOH. Okay? The order of discharge or order of confinement or commitment shall be issued not later than 15 days from the filing of the appropriate petition. Okay? Ngayon, paano pag ano, kailangan pa rin siyang ikulong? Paano yung time na in-spend niya dun sa rehabilitation center? Ike-credit yun in service of sentence. Okay? The accused shall be given full credit for period he was confined in center. If offense is for illegal drug use and accused is not a recidivist, the penalty thereof shall be deemed to have been served in the center upon his release therefrom after certification by the center and board that she or he is rehabilitated. Okay, kung rehabilitated naman na, hindi niya na itutuloy yung kaso niya, ay yung penalty niya. Okay? Pero kung recidivist yan, meaning paulit-ulit na yan, tutuloy niya pa rin, pero ike-credit yung rehabilitation niya. Okay, prescription of offense shall not run during confinement, treatment, or rehabilitation. Okay? Yung period of prescription of the offense charge against a drug dependent under the compulsory submission program shall not run during the time that the drug dependent is under confinement or under the approved treatment and rehabilitation program. If the board certifies na natapos niya talaga yung rehabilitation niya, So, ang gagawin ni court, i-order niya yung final discharge from confinement. Okay? And order for the immediate resumption of the trial of the case for which he is originally charged. Diyan yan sa compulsory confinement, ha? A drug dependent committed is finally discharged from confinement shall be exempt from criminal liability for drug use without prejudice to the outcome of any pending case filed in court. On the other hand naman, ang isang drug dependent na hindi na rehabilitate kahit na after a second commitment shall upon conviction shall suffer the penalties provided for illegal use of drugs. Again, without prejudice to the outcome of any pending case filed in court. Okay, remember that. Okay, what yung mga minor offenders under RA 9344, Juvenile Justice System Act natin. So, alam naman natin sa 9344, yung child 15 years of age pababa at the commission of the offense, time of the commission of the offense. Okay, exempted sila from criminal liability. Okay? Pati yung mga children na above 15 pero below 18 pero walang discernment. Okay? Exempted yung mga yan sa criminal liability. However, subjected sila sa intervention program. Okay? Yung intervention program, I'm sure na-discuss nyo na yan while you are discussing exempting circumstances under book 1. Basically, intervention is i-address yung mga reasons kung bakit nagawa ng bata yan. But a child, yung above 15, below 18 siya, pero mayroong discernment, alam niya yung mali, tama, shall be subjected to diversion proceedings. Okay, when we say diversion naman, from the normal justice system, dadalhin natin siya sa pambatang justice system. Okay? Where the maximum penalty imposed by law for the offense with which the child in conflict with the law is charged is imprisonment of not more than 12 years. But take note na yung exemption ng criminal liability nito. Hindi kasama ang civil liability. Okay, alam nyo naman yan sa book 1 nyo na mga nasa exempted, may civil liability pa rin yan except for accident and insuperable cause. Okay. So, bail, when it is a matter of right. So, lahat ng CICL, Children in Conflict with the Law, shall be admitted to bail as a matter of right before conviction of an offense not punishable by reclusion perpetual life imprisonment. Sa lahat naman yan, hindi naman sa CICL yan. Okay? Pero kapag ang offense niya naman ay punishable by reclusion perpetua or life imprisonment. Basta remember, no child shall be charged with an offense punishable by reclusion perpetua or life imprisonment shall be admitted to bail when the evidence of guilt is strong. So papayagan lang siya when the evidence of guilt is not strong. Okay, the court shall commit the child to a youth detention home or youth rehabilitation center, or in the absence thereof, to the care of a provincial, city, or municipal jail with adequate quarters separate from adults and prisoners of the opposite sex. Doon siya dadalhin. When it comes to the automatic suspension of sentence, if a child is found guilty of an offense charge, the court, instead na i-execute nila yung judgment of conviction, ipe-place nila yung child in conflict with the law under suspended sentence without need of an application. Yung suspension of sentence na yan, pwedeng i-avail yan even if the child is already 18, pero hindi dapat siya mas mataas sa 21 years old at the time of the pronouncement of guilt, kay hindi commission of the offense, ha? Without prejudice to the child's availing of other benefits such as probation, kung qualified siya, or adjustment of penalty in the interest of justice. Okay? Yung benefits ng suspended sentence, hindi yan applicable sa mga CICL who once enjoyed suspension of sentence. Okay? Na-convict na sila dati. But shall nonetheless apply to one who is convicted of an offense punishable by reclusion perpetua or life imprisonment pursuant sa provisions ng RA 9346 na nagpro-prohibit ng imposition ng death penalty. So in lieu, reclusion perpetua na lang daw. And after application of the privilege mitigating circumstance ng minority. Okay, book 1, meron dito itatawag na privilege mitigating sa mga minor. Okay, upon discharge ng CICL, upon recommendation ng social worker na who has custody of the child, the court shall dismiss the case against the child whose sentence has been suspended and against whom disposition measures have been issued. And mag-order sila ng final discharge of the child if it finds that the objective of the disposition measures have been fulfilled. Okay? Nakuha naman na lang yung objective na natin, try na lang gumawa ng mga paraan para mabago itong batang ito. So, wag na natin ikulong, di ba? Yung discharge ng CICL na yan shall not affect the civil liability resulting from the commission of an offense which shall be enforced in accordance with law. Sinong bayad? Yung magulang. Okay? When it comes to the execution of judgment, if the court finds that the objective of the disposition measures hindi naman na-fulfill, o kaya yung CICL na yan hindi siya nakapag-comply with the conditions ng disposition niya or rehabilitation niya, yung CICL shall be brought before the court for execution of judgment. Okay. Ano yung disposition ng bata na ano, na sabi natin 16 siya, tapos dumating na siya sa 18 nung natapos yung disposition niya under suspended sentence pa rin. Okay. Kapag ganun, dadalhin ulit siya sa korte. Sabi natin 16 ka nakakommit ng crime, nilagay ka sa rehabilitation program, suspended yung sentence mo. Okay? Pag naka 18 ka na, pag 18 years old ka na, dadalhin ka ulit sa court. Okay? So, titignan ng court kung nagbago ka na ba or hindi ka talaga magbabago. Okay? Kapag medyo takilid, pwedeng i-extend ng court yung maximum, yung suspended sentence mo hanggang makarating ka ng 21 years old. Okay? Or pwede rin, pag sa tingin talaga ng court, hindi ka na magbabago, i-order niya ng service of sentence mo. Kukulong ka na talaga. Okay? Credit naman sa ano, sa child, sa service of sentence. Yung CICL shall be credited in the services ng sentence niya with the full time na na-spend niya in actual confinement and detention nung nire-rehabilitate siya. So, counted yan. Okay? Babawas yan sa penalty niya. And lastly, pagdating naman sa probation as an alternative imprisonment. So, the court may, after ma-convict and ma-sentence yung bata, upon application, place the child on probation in lieu of service of his sentence, taking into account the best interest of the child. Okay, that is section 42 ng RA 9344. Okay, so that is the provisions on our drugs law. Okay, which is dati Title 5. Since wala nang Title 5 ngayon, ang batas na nag-govern sa atin when it comes to dangerous drugs is the RA 9165, the Comprehensive Dangerous Drugs Act of 2002. Okay? So, thank you for listening and good day.